very good morning to all of you and welcome to the pre-show show. This morning I have Gert on camera with me, also sometimes known by those of you who perhaps struggled with our South African pronunciation as Carrot. How are you this morning, Carrot?
I'm good.
Good, me too. This time, yesterday afternoon, doing the pre-show show, I was weighing up the options of going to Cheetah Plains, and I said it was worth it, it wasn't going to rain. It was worth it, but it did rain. A lot. It rained a lot. And it was touch and go as to whether or not we were going to just have to camp out at Cheetah Plains Lodge underneath one of their roofs, which they very kindly offered us. But we did make it back home. We are alive and well. But here's the funny story. Yesterday, at the end of the sunset safari, I was busy looking for hyena, and Rebecca said, we finished off the show, Rebecca said, and drive is wrapped, thank you very much, and I looked to my right and Karula was just lying there in the road, next to the road, looking at me for all the world like she'd been there the whole time, was wondering where we were. So now we're looking for Karula on this cloudy morning. Do you think we're going to get rained on? I've decided I've not predicting any weather. It's definitely not going to happen. I am useless at predicting the weather. Where to go? What to do? I think we're just going to go very, very slowly and look for post-rain activity. And look out for actual rain activity that might be on its way towards us. Story goes that we're going to get 100 mils tomorrow. I think that might be today. I think it's arriving early, which is very rude to arrive unannounced. But it is good news. Yesterday's rain was perfect. Yesterday was perfect. It was a gentle soaking. Well, gentle is a bit of an understatement. It was a soaking rain. It wasn't a deluge. Now, I know what happens in these places when 100 mils falls in one go, and the results are somewhat flooded, and we generally can't get food in from town, and sometimes we can't get out. I once got trapped on holiday. Doesn't sound like a bad thing, does it? Went on leave, didn't go far from work, it was just down the road. Sunday arrived, it was time to go back. Couldn't get out. Roads were flooded, staying with my friend Emma, and all we had was bacon, because we had not planned on staying an extra 3 days. So we only had bacon, and we learned to eat bacon in a variety of ways. Lots and lots. Thank goodness Emma's more inventive than I am. The worst part of that whole ordeal was the fact that we had no tea. No tea at all. No tea and no coffee. We were positively stranded. And by the time I really did get out of there, to drive through that river, my feet ended up soaked, and I have a new respect for the things that my car can do. Hyena, not leopard. Oh, it's quite the view. It's a beautiful morning though. It does smell so fresh and so clean. And windy. Very windy. Ha! Look at that. There you go, you get a sneak peek into our live safaris. If you have just stumbled upon the stream and it seems very aimless and bumbling, excuse me, it's because we haven't started yet. Just wait until we really get into it. That is going to happen in the next 15 to 20 seconds when we start off our live safari. And all kinds of interesting, fascinating things await. And in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, see you soon.
This program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to a cloudy morning here in the African bush. We're on the fresh tracks of a female leopard. Stay tuned to see if we can find her. This is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
Good morning and welcome to a beautiful Juma private game reserve for your sunrise safari. Now, just after we went off air last night, Jamie managed to find Karula on her way home, right next to camp. Now, we found Karula's tracks this morning. They headed down Philemon's cut line, then they've cut north towards Ingwe Alley and Chelepan. But because of the rain last night, it's going to make tracking incredibly difficult. So we are literally going at snail's pace. There's a diker. Vim has spotted something. Oh, there we go. Sleeping behind the bush. There we go. A little female diker. Definitely going to be keen to avoid. Oh, off she goes. Avoid Karula. Now, I'm hoping the tracks come out at this next junction. If not, we're going to check down towards the Mawati River. And that's a good place to look for tracks after it's been raining, the nice soft sand. And if she's heading north, if she hasn't had success in a hunt, there's a good chance she's going to search around the riverbed and the river banks for Inyala, bushbuck, and the other animals that during that cold, wet, windy weather we had last night will try to take refuge in the thickets. Now, of course, it was perfect hunting weather for a leopard or lion last night with the strong winds and grey skies, so not a lot of ambient light around. And we're hoping that she's had some success. So far, no tracks coming out just here. If we get no success down through here and into the Mawati River, we're going to go back to last tracks, check Ingwe Alley carefully. Jamie's going round the long way to make sure she hasn't crossed to the south. Now, she might have crossed to the south to fetch cubs. You never know. Now, remember, this is 100% live. So we literally could find her around the next corner, or we might not find her at all. That's the joy of being live in the African bush. And remember the hashtag Safari Live, or questions at wildearth.tv if you would like to ask us questions. Now, of course, I'm not the only one out here. As I said, Jamie's also out helping us look for Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard in this area. So let's go say good morning to her.
A very good morning to all of you and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie and this morning I have Gert on camera with me and we are heading out, as Brent explained, to go and search for the Queen of Juma. But since the Queen of Juma can often be relatively elusive, I've decided that this morning is a no pressure drive. We're going to go and see what we can find, the post-rain activities. I was chatting a little bit about this during the pre-show. The Queen has a way of showing up at the most unexpected of times, particularly as Rebecca says, driver's wrapped, right there, right next to my car, as I drove 5 meters down the road. I have to confess, I blinked at her in shock a few times before I actually registered that she was there. She could, in certain patches of this very damp soil, I was chatting earlier, unless she's wearing ankle weights, she's probably not going to leave a footprint in the sand, and she's probably not wearing ankle weights. I think that's safe to say. Leopards do walk with an incredibly light tread, and on days like today, with the clouds in the sky and the damp soil, can be very tricky to spot. Now, we're going to have to get lucky in order to see her, but there's all sorts of other things to see, and I'm hoping for tortoises and insects, and I did have an antlion for you, but it flew away. And because antlions, adults, only live for 24 hours, some species, I didn't want to remove it from where it had the potential of mating with other antlions, so I don't still have it in the car with me. I have left it to go about its life cycle. We might see dung beetles, we might see all sorts of things. And usually after the rain, you also find that the birds are a great deal more vocal. I've said all of this, now I just have to find something. And of course, most of the animals tend to hide away on days like today. They don't have to worry about coming out into the open to a waterhole to drink. There'll be puddles in different places. And really, they're just sort of standing shivering somewhere, sheltering from the wind, and probably being thankful that they made it through, as Brent explained earlier, made it through the very, very dangerous night. And baby impala. I've been looking for baby impala as well. Sure, that looks like it's pouring down over Bushbuck Ridge. I'll try and show you in a moment. Hold on, get to an open area. Bushbuck Ridge is an area outside of the reserve. It is not too far away from us, and it borders... No, hyena again. They walk with a much heavier step than leopards do. But yes, Bushbuck Ridge is neighbouring parts of the Sabi Sand, or close to the parts of the southern Sabi Sand. And it always, always gets a little bit more rain than we do. I'll show you now. Sure, you can't even see the mountains. Usually when we look across to the west of us in this direction, we can see the imposing silhouette of a mountain range known as the Drakensberg, which is an exceptionally large mountain range that extends throughout the country. And at the moment, all I can see is cloud and mist and rain. I think there's a very good chance that there will be more the further into the day we go. I hope there'll be more. What often happens is we watch the rain go past in that direction along that band. Yeah, I think there's a good chance that there's going to be more rain. I hope so. Sorry, I'm distracted by my Game Drive radio. Ooh, pretend that didn't happen. Distracted by my Game Drive radio. I'm just listening, and that's the way that we contact other guides and chat to them and coordinate our search and share our sightings with everybody else. Right, where should we go? Let's go this way. We'll go and check the southern boundary. See if the Queen went to go and fetch her little ones from the southern side of our traverse area and bring them back. Birds are too quiet this morning. Okay. This is relatively loose soil, so we should see if she's here. The reason I'm not trying to track down the hyenas, for those of you that are hyena lovers, yesterday at the end of the sunset safari, we had the spotted hyena around Sydney's Dam, which is north of our boundary. They disappeared very quickly. Now, the reason I'm not trying to track them down from these tracks is it's almost impossible to track a hyena. They move much, much faster and more deliberately than the cats tend to. The cats tend to walk, lie down, have a little bit of a snooze, get up, walk some more, lie down, have a bit of a snooze, and rinse and repeat. Whereas hyena go straight. And unless there's a kill or something around here, which judging by their tracks there isn't, it's just one set of tracks moving north, it's probably just a hyena making a beeline back towards Buffalo's Hook and Manuleti. Okay, I think we're going to have to take the main road. There's no way I'm going to see tracks on this firebreak. And yesterday, of course, just finishing off our summary of yesterday's wonderful sunset safari, we were on Cheetah Plains and we were treated to an incredible surprise sighting. And it was as much a surprise for me as it was for all of you, but a surprise sighting of the brand new weeks old Styx lion cubs. It was absolutely wonderful to see them, especially after all the Styx have been through. So cute. Michael, you want to know if I know where the Styx pride went? I don't, but we will find out from some of the other guides who work on cheetah plains and who are based on cheetah plains. So when Mike and Ephraim get up, not get up, they're up already, we're guides, we're up already, but when they get out on the road and when they move into the northern section of this reserve, we'll be able to find out from them if they are still there. And if they are still around, and the weather looks like it's going to hold, because I took a little bit accidentally, I didn't realize I was doing it, but I took a little bit of a chance yesterday with the rain. But if they are still around, then we'll head back in that direction. But I'm waiting for now. We'll wait and see what they say. If they're there, then we'll go. It'll be so exciting. Those little things are just too sweet. And we're lucky to see them. I was going there for cheetah. The cheetah, by the way, vanished. After all of that, the cheetah had gone south into Mala Mala. So there were no cheetah, but there were surprise lion cubs. Well, I think that Brent and I have had a similar thought as to where the queen might have vanished to. Let's go and have a look at what's happening in a riverbed.
Now we're just double checking that she hasn't popped down into the Mawati River. We've checked up to the north as far as you can drive in the riverbed, and there's no sign of her tracks coming down. This is actually one of her favorite paths down through here and into the river, but no sign of the tracks here. So we're gonna check a little bit further to the south before heading back towards the area where we had her last tracks. Now, outside of the soft sand areas, Jamie's 100% correct. Karula's going to need ankle weights, or we're going to need some extra human vision to spot the tracks today. But I think Vim and I are on it. Of course, we are very happy to be tracking leopards. Now, Vim and I had a discussion this morning. What are we going to look for, lions or leopards? And I said, let's go look for lions. Vim said, no, he's feeling leopard. So when Vim's feeling leopard, it's generally a good sign we're going to find one. Now, in this area, we did see some tracks of Inyala running at speed. So we're going to go a little bit further to the south in the riverbed. And who knows, maybe she'll pop out, or at least her tracks will pop out. And fortunately, in the soft sand, one of the reasons we're utilizing this soft sand this morning is it is one of the best places to see tracks. See, there's the antelope running tracks. You can see there, they're very indistinct because the animal was moving at speed. Could it have spotted Karula is the question. Running tracks. Still no leopard tracks though. And we're definitely not going to miss tracks in this sand today. We always check these major game paths coming through. No fresh tracks after the rain here, so we'll keep going. Of course, we've been forewarned about this deluge that's coming. Maybe yesterday was just a pre-warning to what is awaiting us over the weekend. Yeah. I think if we get 120 millimeters in a day, we'd be underwater right now. We have a very distinct track marching down the riverbed there. And you can see very, very close together footprints. In lots of parts of Africa, they form highways. And let's just get everyone's brain on the move and see who knows what track is that, what animal walks like that. Very small shuffling footsteps. There we go. If you know what track that is, let me know. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions at wildearth.tv on email. Now we just gotta hope that they were early, but they look like they were quite early this morning, so we gotta hope that they don't obliterate Karula's tracks. If she came here, of course. Okay, so far, no sign of the Queen of Juma. So let's head back towards where we had her last tracks. As I said, Jamie's checking around the edge to make sure she hasn't crossed out of our traverse area. Probably at one of the lowest points at Juma at the moment, and Safari's wondering what part of Juma has the highest elevation. There's a couple of spots. I would say Cheetah Cutline, pretty high, and the area around Sandy Patch, and then of course the area just to the south of Impala Plains where the Gowrie Repeater, which helps send this incredible picture through the world, is located. Okay, no sign of her in the Mawati, so we're gonna head back towards the last tracks, and fingers crossed maybe there's a tree climbing impala or a tree climbing diker. That of course is out of their normal nature unless they've been caught by a leopard and put there. Now, I'm relying on my many years in the bush to hopefully see a track today, and it is going to be reasonably difficult. Or even better, hopefully she just walks down the road towards us. So even though it's quite grey, it's not that cold. It's about 22 degrees Celsius, 75 Fahrenheit. Clouds are quite high, so no sign of rain at the moment, but that could change in an instant. Well done to James and Kyle, you're spot on indeed. Those are the shuffling footprints of the sea cow, or sometimes even called Satan's pig, the hippo. Now, the reason hippos have got the nickname Satan's pig is because they are incredibly dangerous to human beings, and they actually kill more human beings than any other mammal in Africa. And most of that is on the water, rural fishermen on their little dugout canoes, but also at night when they come out of the water and quite often will feed very close to human habitation. We've had the hippo all around recently, and even last night we had one in the garden, which is not a place you want a hippo. So the hippo last night managed to push the gate open and come feed on the lung grasses in the garden because no other animals there. So I don't know how he did it. He must have used his nose and pushed the gate that the elephants bent. And he also decided to do something quite silly, which was walk on the deck. The deck's not in a good way this morning, but I'm quite sure we're hopefully gonna get that gate fixed ASAP. But while we continue our search for the Queen of Juma and our avoidance of hippopotamus on foot, let's go see how Jamie's search further to the southwest of us is going.
I hear that you've been talking about hippo with Brent, and it brings to mind a story where I first discovered my brother's hidden athletic prowess. Many, many years ago, because my brother's much, much younger than me, many years ago we were staying at an area close to Hazyview on the Sand River. And so Hazyview is to the south of us. It's quite close to Paul Kruger Gate in the southern part of the Kruger. And an area renowned for the number of hippopotamus. As you might guess, it's the Sand River. There's lots of sand in the Sabi River flow pretty much permanently. Anyway, the one evening we were wandering along from where we were staying to dinner, and there is a certain complacency that we as South Africans get every now and again until we have a near miss, and then we go back to being alert and careful. And we were wandering to dinner. And these people very, very kindly from their room wanted to warn us about the hippo. But the way in which they did that was by shining the light straight at us, blinding us and going, "Be careful, the hippo," which turned out to be a bull that was standing about, I don't know, let's try not to exaggerate the big fish kind of story. It was probably about 20 or so meters away from us. And we turned and we ran. Which you shouldn't, we always talk about the fact that you don't run, but in this particular situation, here's a stumble key. Hold on, put that story on hold while we put our little stumble on camera. Hello, little one. And you saw a dacre with Brent. Now we've got the other dwarf antelope of this area. Could see a sharp's grasbok, but that's very, very unlikely. This little male steenbok will do for this morning. Oh, such a beautiful little antelope. Trot, 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 trot. Here he goes. And somewhere around here, he would have been sleeping and he would have woken up with his mate in this territory, assuming that he is a male that's established a territory and has managed to find himself a lady friend. So he would have spent the night, the two of them mate for life. So they would have, and it's actually quite a lovely story, they would have spent last night cuddled up together next to each other in some dense vegetation. And then they wake up, stretch, groom each other a little bit, and then off they go in different directions. Not far from each other because their territories aren't that big. But they'll go off and they'll go forage all by themselves, but always sort of within a distance that they know. They're aware of where their mate is. I can't see him anymore. Can you see him? You can. Oh, awesome. So there's the little boy with his dagger-like horns. And presumably the little female is somewhere around here. Might be a young male in search of a territory and in search of an opportunity to mate with a female. That could be. We can't make too many assumptions about him. But there are... Sorry, that's my fault, not Gert's fault. I just haven't taken my foot off the brake. There are... The dwarf antelope are all monogamous. So they live together in monogamous pairs, which is quite unusual. And there's actually not that many mammal species out here that adopt that way. That's that kind of social structure. Jackal, dwarf antelope, wild dogs to an extent. Wild dogs, but even then, a little bit of stuff, a little bit of mating will occasionally happen on the side, especially with the beta female of the pack. Anyway, back to the hippo story. My brother has always been, he's very, very bright. So he's focused a lot on academics and music, and he hasn't necessarily pursued the sports kind of activities. But I have to tell you, I don't think I have ever seen him. I mean, I was 8 years older than him at the time. He must have been about 10. I have never seen anybody move that fast. My mom impressed me as well, actually, both of them. It's quite extraordinary what you discover about a human being's athletic ability when push really comes to shove. I ran behind a big tree and stopped to check that everyone was okay. They were practically back in Johannesburg by the time they stopped running. And unfortunately, my poor dad had got the full brunt of the other people's spotlight. So he's obviously got bright flashing lights whenever he blinks his eyes. He didn't see the hippo at all. So he's still standing there going, where? Where, what hippo? shame. It was an interesting experience. We laughed about it afterwards. But an important lesson to, first of all, always carry torches. And if you ever find yourself in a position at night that you're trying to warn people about something, preferably don't shine your light directly at them. Ideally, you shine it on the animal, but rather than shining it straight in their eyes. Woodlands. Good morning. Feels like they never left. All of a sudden, the air is constantly filled with the cry of the woodland kingfisher. Come on, everybody's calling around you. One more time for us. It's the one bird, not the one bird call, one of the many bird calls that I've never been able to imitate. This is a migrant species for those of you that are joining us for the first time. In other words, they have only just returned, not quite from distant shores, but from further north up into Africa. They've only just returned in the last few days, and it goes from no woodland to lots of woodlands everywhere, constantly calling. Don't stop now on my account. You were calling so nicely earlier. Of course, the power lines make for a perfect vantage point for birds like kingfishers, rollers. You'll find a lot of the birds perch up here. And weavers as well will also do that. They will even construct their nests on power lines. They're just thoroughly convenient. And like all animals out here, they are very good at making the most of what they have. Whether it's a power line or a roof eave in the form of the starlings' nests. Come on, one more call for us. Oh, sorry, let me just take my foot off the brake, because that's my fault, the camera's wobbling like that. Not looking as bedraggled as I expected. I don't think it rained at all last night, after we closed down our sunset safari. Okay, kingfisher, 15 seconds, and then I'm going to move. Sorry, fly up my nose. This is just being stubborn. It was calling so beautifully as I pulled up. Yay! There we go. Such a pretty call. One more time. We'll also have a chance to see them do their mating displays to each other, where they fly up and they lift up their wings and they do the strange little bowing motion. Can't describe it, you just have to see it. Especially since I cannot imitate their calls. Now, Amka, you wanted to know if any of the birds here will migrate from Asia. Amka, I don't know if you've ever heard of Amur falcons, A-M-U-R, Amur falcons. It's the largest migration of any, mass migration of any predatory bird or any raptor. So the Amur falcons travel all the way through India, through to Africa, and then down to South Africa in these massive groups, millions of them collecting, often following things like insect explosions, termite explosions, and bat migrations as well. The two of them are linked. So that is one type of thing. Steppe buzzards and steppe eagles come through from Russia, from the steppe mountains in those areas. What else am I missing? I'm sure I'm forgetting something. Steppe buzzards, steppe eagles, Amur falcons. I have not brought my bird book out because I was worried about it getting thoroughly drenched. I've already wrecked several books, bird books in that manner. I'm going to think about whether there are other species, but those are the ones that immediately come into my mind. So yes, there are birds that do migrate from Asia. And then of course we get the swallows, the bee eaters, and shrikes as well, all coming through from Europe, storks. And then a lot of our birds are intra-African migrants, so they come from Central to Northern Africa. We get arrivals from all parts of the world here in South Africa. Now, David, you wanted to know if they migrate for the food or because of the weather. It's mainly food-based, so their migration is mainly based on food. Although I imagine that weather, if I were a bird and I had wings, the weather might play an important part in my decision-making. But no, instinctively it's to follow the patterns of insect explode, mainly insects, bats, and other such things. And they come through to an area that's more suitable for them to breed in. Of course, you do get migratory species, and this I only learnt... excuse me. This I only learnt whilst working with Safari Live, because I was under this misapprehension that birds migrate, all species of birds migrated here to breed. And that's not actually the case. I don't know why I was under that misapprehension, because now that I think about it, of course, storks go to Europe to breed. Or some of them do. I'm sorry. I've got a tickle in my throat that I can't get rid of. And red-backed shrikes also do not breed when they come through to South Africa in our summer. And the reason that we do know that it is largely food-based in terms of migration is that because last year, during our drought, or during the time of the drought, there was very little insect, very little seed activity, very little for the birds to eat. And as a result, we actually... The species arrived initially, and then they slowly but surely disappeared. The Deirdre's cuckoos, the Classis cuckoos, all of them, not all of them, but we didn't have them in the numbers that I would have expected during our summer months, and that's because they moved to areas closer to the mountains where there was more food available. Hey, little woodlands, you guys are loyal, though. You're always here. Always around. Now the next kingfisher to get on camera... is a pygmy, also intra-African. Hopefully they will be popping round to Inga's pool in the not-too-distant future. There we go. So, Rich, Levi, you want to know, well, we've got these arrivals. Where have they come from? Towards central and then maybe a little bit into northern Africa, but not so much. So it's more around the sort of central African areas. That's where... Oh, my goodness gracious. There's something in the air, clearly. So that's where they'll move from. So it's not one of the biggest... It's not in terms of distance, it's not the longest migration. But they will come through from the central northern Africas. I think they actually will stay in Zambia. So it can be as far south as countries like Zambia and northern parts of Botswana. But it's more towards central Africa that they go to during our winter months. And, of course, the closer they get to the equator, the less of a sort of big difference there is between winter and summer. Whereas South Africa, we're quite far south, so we do get quite a large difference in our animals adapt and change as a result. All right, Mr. Woodlands, thank you, or Mrs., thank you for calling. Sounds like a call center. Aaron, very good question. Which migratory kingfisher migrates the furthest? Sorry, I'm thinking. I'm trying to think. I'm just going through a list of kingfisher species in my head, and I'm going to go with probably the woodlands. Yeah, I'm going to go. I think the woodlands probably migrates the furthest of the kingfishers that we see. But there might be kingfishers in other parts of the world that migrate even further. Sorry, I was just looking at what I thought was a track, but it wasn't. Can I get back to you on that, Aaron? Because I don't know. I'm not 100% sure. Much in the same way I wasn't 100% sure last night where a rhino beetle's eyes are. And I'm still not 100% sure exactly where a rhino beetle's eyes are. I tried to find out, but it's a bit of a confusing one. They've got a very odd facial structure. I'll get back to you, Aaron. I'll double check. I think that for the kingfishers we see, it's probably the woodlands. If only for the fact that they're usually one of the latest to return. I'm going to go and check on, speaking of birds this morning, I'm going to go and check on a nest site that I know of. So while we do that, let's go and see what Brent is up to.
Yeah, so Karula did a bit of trickery on us, and she actually just sort of moved through the bush very close to the road. We lost the tracks again just down here. So now she's gone into an area where it's nearly impossible to see tracks. So now it's time for a bit of gambling. We're spinning that wheel of fortune and heading towards an area she spends a lot of time. I just want to check exactly where Gemma is. Jamie. Also heard some lions roaring toward the east of us, so if we get no luck, we'll go look there. Whereabouts are you at the moment? Okay, copy out. Last tracks seem to be heading south in the block between Weaver's Nest and that Skabanga Road, but I can't find anything coming out, but I think that's a good idea. I'm going to check Philemon's to Shabam. Did you find any tracks on the boundary? So we're just coordinating our movements. Copy, thanks. So Judy H has got to know us all quite well over the years, and Vim is not a fan of the giraffe or sunsets. Now, Vim and I tend to lean towards the same type of sightings, and Judy H says, how about an incentive for Vim? If he spots Karula, he can skip 3 giraffes and 1 sunset. Vim, what do you think about that? Now he's picked up, Judy. You've got him awake. His head is on a veritable swivel at the moment. We're just going to double check she hasn't gone through Shabam. Jamie's coming up towards Treehouse Dam from that way, so we're covering all our bases. Can see there's not much else out. I haven't even seen an impala yet this morning. Ooh, Sozman Sparkles has come up with a brilliant question. And it's, where do I think in Africa has the most variety of antelope species? Sure, now that's an interesting one. So generally you've got a lot of the same species throughout, and your greater kudu, impala, wildebeest, duiker, steenbok, what other antelope, bushbuck occur everywhere throughout Africa. I don't know, I think I'm probably going to have to go with somewhere in the Central African Republic. There's a, just before I joined Safari Live, we were actually planning, what's that, Vim? No. I was part of a team that were planning to go up to Central Africa and document this particular area for the formation of a new national park, but then unfortunately the political and demographic of the country changed very much, and violence became very, very hectic, and it became unsafe to go into those areas. It's also an area where the Lord's Liberation Army operates, which is basically a private army, but the Joseph Kony is the the head of that. Apparently he's dead now and his son's taking over, but still very, very unstable and violent part of the world. But it is an incredible part of the world because it's one of the few places where rainforest meets open savanna. So you've got bongos and eland, and you've got cob and forest dikers. So I'm just trying to run through my head how many different antelope species you can get there. I mean, obviously the two big ones is Lord Derby's eland and bongo. You've also got chimpanzees and gorillas and lions and cheetah in the same area and wild dogs. So it's a really fascinating area where the forest ends and it comes into the sort of mosaic and then into proper savanna. So it's right on the eastern side of the Central African Republic. Still a place. It's on. I will get there one day once things have calmed down a bit. But let me just think about this now. So we got bongo, eland, greater kudu. I think about miombo species, harter beast, impala, normal diker, grey diker. I'm not sure about steenbok, but then you've got about five different species of forest diker. Oh, where are you guys going? They've flown quite far. And you got them on that bottom branch there. Right in the distance. There, I think it was. Let me go forward a little bit for you, Vim. But you're on the right tree. I just think, what's wrong with the gearbox this morning? It's a bit cold. Yeah, there we go. Oh no, a little bit to the right. I think that Terminalia is in the way. Okay. Through that gap. Where are they now? I can hear them. They're behind there. Oh, there we go. There they are. There we go. Ground scraper thrushes. Very noisy this morning, a pair of ground scraper thrush. Of course, they'll be loving the soft ground that they can pry insects out of. Okay, so I was trying to work out. So, I mean, I think there's probably 40, there's bushbuck there. There was 12, Sudatunga, 13, Watershed retained. That's not really an antelope, it's a half antelope, half pig. Yes, I would say probably that's got the most diverse antelope species. Another interesting thing, it's got lions, chimpanzees, gorillas. It's a very, very difficult area to get to. One of the most rural and least explored areas left in Africa. And of course, that's what attracts me to it. And I've been very lucky that I've got to go to places that people cannot even imagine. I thought I heard an alarm call. I'm just listening quickly. Nah. Nope. So I've been very fortunate. There are very few people who have been into some of the places I've been in Zambia and in southern Tanzania and Gabon. Lots of rural places in Botswana and Namibia. Even places in South Africa that most people don't even know exist. Viam and I actually went to one of those not so long ago, up on the Luvuvu River. So there's always that wanderlust for the great unknown, and there's so few of those areas left. And the adventure in my soul cannot say no to those type of places. South Sudan I've been to. Again, not a place one should go to lightly. Got to wear bulletproof vests while we were there. Nothing like going to bed with the sound of machine gun fire. Of course, I'm joking. It's very unpleasant and quite stressful. Okay, well, we're going to keep searching for Kurula, but shh, don't tell Jamie about the bulletproof vest and going to bed with machine gun fire, but let's go see what she's up to.
Well, Brent and myself carry on our search for the Queen of Juma. I'm very much hoping to find a tortoise, and I'm quite disappointed that I have not yet found a tortoise. I see their tracks all over the road, and they, unlike leopards, tend to leave very, very prominent tracks. Sorry, I'm just checking. This is one of Karula's favorite areas. There's a big dried-up riverbed that runs through here, and it's got the perfect hidey holes for something like a leopard. Oh, very nice. I did say that we're not just looking for leopards, we're looking for other exciting things. And in particular, I'm interested in seeing the bird life now that the rains have come and gone. And there is one very bedraggled looking batelier. One of the most striking birds of prey that we see out here. Looking a little bit windswept, feathers a little bit ruffled. But that bright orange face and their bright orange legs. They're also known as the short-tailed snake eagle. Although to me, a batelier, the batelier name just sounds that little bit cooler. Giving us a view of the ruffled brown feathers at the back. This is a boy, or a male batelier, actually, let's be fair. He's a male batelier, fully grown. It does take them 7 years to attain this adult colouring. When they hatch, when they fledge, the juveniles and the sub-adults are a sort of a nondescript brown colour. But the adult batelias attain this very striking combination of black, white, brown and red. Oh, doing some really hard work there, realigning all of its feathers after what was probably quite a windswept night. And all of the feathers have to be laid out properly in order for it to dry properly. They've got to make sure that preening is so essential to making sure that their feathers work. And of course, their feathers are essential to keeping them airborne. On a day like today, it's actually that things like the larger birds of prey, the vultures, will struggle a little bit to fly around because they have to wait for the hot air to rise. But batelias don't need to worry too much about that. And it's not uncommon to see them swooping low to the ground. One of the things about their short tails, hence the name short-tailed eagle, and the fact that you can't really see its tail from this angle, is that they tend to have quite an unstable flight. So it's a very easy bird to recognize straight away. And it's a very, for those of you, or for those who are beginning their birding skills in South Africa, it's one of the first birds of prey that you learn to identify in flight. And of course, it has the added advantage of being one of the only birds of prey where the dimorphism between males and females become very, very clear. So most of the birds of prey, the only difference... Oh, goodness. Such an enthusiastic greeting from Brent to Herbie there in my ear. Yes, the females have more white than the males. In other birds of prey, only real way you can tell the difference is to look at the difference in size. Are we going to leave our bedraggled batelier? Oh, I think that's a lovely description. Bedraggled batelier, and go off and see if we can't find some other things. We are going, if we don't find a leopard, we are going to find a leopard tortoise. And I'm very, very sorry. And I've got the question there, but I don't think the person who sent through the question's name is Eggsack. But that's what I heard. Chad, do you have any ideas? I heard Eggsack. S-hack. S-hack? Is that right? Did I get that right? Yay! Sorry, sometimes it doesn't always come through that clearly. So S-hack, not Eggsack. You want to know if we have any parrots on Juma. We do. We have mainly the brown-headed parrot. We do also get a type of parrot known as a Mayor's parrot that you occasionally see more in the northern parts of Kruger. I used to see them much more towards the sort of northwestern parts, actually a province called the Northwest Province. Up towards a interesting little town known as Aldeys. So we get brown-headed parrots here. We often hear them. They can be quite secretive birds. They often like to hide in dense vegetation. But I'll see if I can't find you a parrot, because we definitely, definitely do get them here. And every now and again, you've got the chance of seeing a lost grey-headed parrot. I'm going to try just give you one last view of this battalier, because this is quite a nice shot. It's difficult with the grey skies. You don't get the full impression of just how beautiful they really are. But he's giving us a really nice view of his wings. And there, of course, underneath his whitish-greyish, it's actually a more greyish patch, in females they have an extra band of white that sits underneath there. You can see the tips of his wings sticking even further out than the end of his tail. Now just bear with me one second. Herbert is trying to get hold of me. Standing by, Herbie. Ephemeral, Herbs, we did. Striking bird. Okay. So Herbert is a Juma guide who helps us out, helps Wild Earth out in terms of his tracking abilities as well as a security detail for us when we do go out on walk. So what he does is he helps to make sure that we're safe. He's very, very alert. His bush skills are incredible. And he just moves slightly ahead of us to make sure that we're not going to be surprised by anything. Although a surprise leopard would be quite nice right now. Okay, so no tracks crossing there. Let's go and try a road we call a pangolin track. So essentially Brent and myself are circling the area that he had the last tracks in. I'm trying to check it. She's such an unpredictable, all leopards are unpredictable, but Karula especially so. It's very difficult to predict exactly where she's going to go. I'm going to go off a hunch and go and check a road called Nyala Road South. But before I do, I think I see some impala. Let's check and see if we've got any little ones. There's going to be an explosion of population very, very shortly. Seen the first few impala lambs? Now we're just waiting on the rest of them. They're all looking a little bit damp. And unfortunately, the vegetation has changed completely over the last few months. So sightings that might have been easy once upon a time have become more and more difficult. You're still pregnant. One at the back still pregnant. Heavily, heavily pregnant. No sign of any little jumping lambs. Yesterday morning we were treated to such a beautiful sighting of an impala lamb, playing, jumping, full of the joys of spring. Standing by. I know you're more than welcome to go. Okay, copy. I'm going to take Nyala Road South, Battalier. I'm going to check that area just on a hunch. Sorry, everybody. I'm just planning our search with Brent, so where we're going to go. And he's just telling me where he's checked. Okay, copy. Thanks very much. I'll check Weaver's Nest, Nyala Road, Battalier, all those roads. Okay, sorry about that. We just had to coordinate our search efforts and decide which of us was going to go to another sighting, not a Karula sighting, but a different sighting. And Brent will be heading across in that direction in a little bit. And Toby, you want to know if anybody has seen the first baby gazelle of the season. Oh, Homie. Not Toby. Homie, I'm doing really well with all of your names this morning. I'm sorry. Homie, we have seen our first baby impala. Now, they are just a subtle distinction. It's not a hugely important one, but just in terms of the correctness of identifying the different antelope. A gazelle is actually a specific type of antelope. So we don't have any gazelle in this area, but there's things like Thompson's gazelle. There's lots of different gazelle up further north in Africa and on the sort of eastern edge. So Kenya, Tanzania, that's where you get a lot of gazelles. We don't get a gazelle. We have impala, so we have seen baby impala. We've got Nyala, we've seen baby Nyala as well. So a lot of our antelope have started to give birth, and there's a lot of little baby antelope wandering around. So if you think of the distinction, for those of you who are confused by the terminology between gazelle and antelope, the different antelope families are... antelope are divided into different tribes. So all gazelle are antelope, but not all antelope are gazelle. Just like all toads are frogs, but not all frogs are toads. Gets a little bit confusing. Rebecca is puzzled. So all types of gazelle are antelope, but not all antelope are classified as gazelle. Sounds like one of those IQ tests. If all wimbles are wombles and all mumbles are nimbles and... I know what I mean. Hey, Ishak says that they're changing their name to Eggsack. I'm so sorry about that, but I'm glad to hear that you took it in your stride. My apologies. Sometimes the names don't come through as clearly as we would like. And on that note, it's not just us out and about looking for things this morning. Byron is on foot. Let's go so that he can say good morning.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Bushwalk. My name is Byron. On camera this morning with me is Jandre, and then, of course, we've got Herbie with us again. And we are just getting started on our bushwalk. We've come to the clearings just outside of camp, not too far from camp. Beautiful area around here, nice and open, so we wanted to have a look around. And I know Jamie has been discussing the impala births with you, and I've managed to find something quite interesting just over here on the ground. And if you look, there's actually a bit of blood around this area. Now, what this would most likely have been from is an impala birth, probably yesterday sometime. It has dried up quite a bit, and we did have rain last night, so I don't think this was during the evening. It was yesterday, but this is most likely some blood left over from an impala birth. And the reason I also say that is because impala do prefer giving birth out on the clearings. It's nice and open, so it gives them an opportunity to have a look out for any potential predators. They are extremely vulnerable when they are giving birth, so they can give birth out here. The lamb has got a few minutes to basically find its legs and get up and start moving around, which is incredible. The impala lambs, it takes them about 5 to 10 minutes before they're able to get up and run around and stick with the female. It's incredibly quick. If you think of an animal that's got to give birth, for that short space of time to get up and run around is really incredible. And of course they have to do this for safety. As the animals, especially these impala lambs, are born, they are very, very vulnerable, and predators will be watching out for them and looking for them. So they need to be able to get up very quickly and move around with the females and keep up with them. We are going to continue through the clearings and see what else we can find. There was some guinea fowl with us earlier walking along not far from us, but they seem to have disappeared. And I'm actually very excited about the bushwalk this morning.
Because of all the rain last night, I'm hoping that we find a lot of interesting little insects. Maybe some scorpions, maybe some more spiders, who knows what else. It is still very, very cool. The temperature is not quite as warm as it was. Sorry, just watch out here. Don't want you to fall over. Temperature is not nearly as warm as it was yesterday. So only about 22 degrees Celsius or 78 Fahrenheit, which is nice. I just spotted something over here, which is quite interesting. And we always speak about termites, but they are such fascinating creatures. Now this piece of wood has fallen over, just a piece of a branch that's broken off. I'm not too sure, possibly from this marula tree behind me. But what's happened is termites have come and invaded this piece of wood, and you can see they've caked it full of soil, and the reason for that is they're breaking it down. Now I don't want to move it or disturb it, because they've clearly set up almost, not quite a colony, but a feeding area that they've been breaking down this wood, so I wouldn't want to disturb them. I'm sure there are termites underneath there, but it's incredible to see how they dig up soil underneath the wood, and while they're feeding on and breaking the wood down, they pack soil around it. The reason for that is probably to protect themselves, so they can feed and break down that wood very easily while they're protected by the soil around them. A lot of impala dung around here. Again, just that goes hand in hand with our theory of that impala birth, or that bit of blood that we saw back there. You can see there's a lot of impala dung, and I'll try to show you some pellets. Here, a few right here. Some young impala pellets just all over here, actually. And again, for safety, there are a lot of these antelope species, impala, wildebeest, they'll all come out onto the clearings basically for safety, so that they can keep an eye out for predators and also warn each other if there is any danger around. Also get zebras coming out onto the clearings, which is which again, hand in hand, more animals around, they're able to keep out, able to keep an eye out for predators. I'm just going to be crossing a road now. Kenny, interesting question about the weather and how it affects the prey species, and are they more vulnerable in this weather? So Kenny, we discussed it yesterday, and we saw a little bit, we saw a male lion. He was resting in the rain. And you want to know if the prey species are more vulnerable in this weather. Now, when it rains, it does mask the smell of the predators and also covers the sound that they would make. So a lot of prey species would need to be very, very careful just of basically looking out for predators, because they can't hear them and they can't smell them. So what happens is, in weather like this, they may be slightly more vulnerable, because if it is windy or if it is cooler, they might not be able to pick up on the scent. But I would say more so in rain, not really in weather like this. They would still be able to keep a lookout, and they'd probably pick up on the sound of some animals. In the rain though, yes, they would definitely be more vulnerable. Not so much because they are cold, and you wanted to know if the cold affects them. No, the cold wouldn't affect them. These animals adapt to the different weather conditions and climate that we have around here, so the cold wouldn't affect them at all. They'll still be able to move very quickly away from predators. All right, so we're going to continue and head south. That's our plan for this morning. While we're heading south, let's head back to Brent for an update and see what he's got.
Look at this, isn't that wonderful? As you can see, a very distinct elephant track in the road this morning, heading towards the east. And hopefully we catch up with Ellie. But I heard that something happened after dark last night, and it is interesting news, but I'm not going to tell you what. We're going to wait till we get there. While we meander towards that direction, you know, chatting about different parts of Africa that I've been lucky enough to travel to. And so I lived in Botswana for over 10 years. I actually lived in the Okavango Delta, and the Okavango Delta is relatively well explored, but there's some incredible things you can do. There's a thing called the Trans-Okavango. That's where you start from the Namibian border, of Botswana, where the Okavango River comes into Botswana, and you go through the whole Okavango River on boat and end up in the town I grew up in called Maun, which is sort of the gateway to the Okavango. It's where all the safari lodges offices are based. Hello, little cold one. Oh, he's gonna run. And off he goes. Chup, Stenborgi. So quick. And some of the harder to get to and more interesting parts of Botswana are well off the beaten track. So everyone knows about the Okavango. There's an incredible place though called Tweaba. Tweaba, well, for those of you who don't know much about Botswana, most of Botswana is very flat and very sandy. Kalahari Sands, Kalahari Desert. But now in that desert, there's a place called Tweaba, and you approach Tweaba in this massive ancient riverbed. So from many hundreds, thousands of years ago, suddenly you've just got these cliff faces, and I mean they're good 4 meters high, and this massive riverbed. And as you drive up this riverbed, you come to a group of hills called the Tweaba Hills, and it used to be called the Drotsky's Hills, and that was the first European to find them, but the local San name or Bushman name is Tweaba, and there's incredible caves there. And we went with a very good friend of my dad's who makes IMAX movies. As kids, we went along to quite a few of the different. What have you spotted, Vim? Oh, what Jamie was looking for. That's a Speke's hinged tortoise on a mission. Off you go, little guy. Oh, he's a highly mobile tortoise. You can see that little hinge on his back there. So he's able to close up the back of his legs. Oh, he's going to head into the bush where he feels safe. There we go. So he's pretending we can't see him now. I'm just a stone under a bush. I'm not here. Very cute little guys. Now, of course, the tortoises, after a bit of rain, are going to be up and about. And they've come out of a long, dry season where they've been keeping their body rates down to a minimum. Now there's lots of green grass and water, so they're able to move. Well, we'll leave him to pretend to be a rock. So, and in the main sort of Tweaba caverns, which are massive, there's a little side cavern that you duck down and you go through, and it's called Moab, is what it was nicknamed by everyone there while we were filming. And it is, Moab stands for the mother of all bat caves. Now there are so many bats in this cave that you cannot stay in the bottom of the cave while you're filming without oxygen, because they use, without an oxygen mask or diving apparatus, because what happens is they literally take in all that oxygen, and with all their defecation and urine, they drop massive amounts of ammonia and carbon dioxide. So you're literally unable to breathe down there. And when you're caving, which I've actually done quite a bit of, the most important thing to remember is to always keep a lighter with you. And I thought that was quite a strange thing, but it's absolutely amazing. So the lower the oxygen level gets when you flick the lighter for the flame, so if you're out here in this perfect out in the open, if I light a lighter, the flame will start at the base of the lighter all the way to the top. But as you go deeper underground in those caves, as you light a lighter, the flame, there'll be actually no flame and then a flame above. So there's a gap and then the flame starts. So that's where the oxygen's burning off. It's really, really interesting. And there's a whole bunch of cave systems around there. We went into Pristine Cave. Less than 100 people have ever been into that cave. And incredible stalactites and stalagmites and helictites and helicmites. Crystal white and beautiful. We managed to go down until we actually ran out of oxygen there. And we had to come back up, because the caves got too small to actually take the breathing apparatus down with. So I think they have explored further now since then. And then my favorite cave was Bone Cave. And we went about 125 meters under the ground. And Bone Cave is basically a series of collapsed caves. So for the first 70 or 80 meters, you're on your back sliding between rocks with the old cave roof just above your head. And then you get down into it and there's amazing, there's zebra jaw bones and stuff fossilized there. But the most incredible thing about Bone Cave is there's a complete aardvark skeleton that is busy being fossilized. They reckon it's about 100 years old. So there are these sort of old volcanic sort of lava tubes, and this aardvark fell down one of them and just died right there. And slowly as the stalactites drip water on it, it's starting to fossilize, but it's a complete perfect aardvark skeleton. And that's in a very, very hard to get to and little known part of Botswana. But now we've arrived at the surprise. Ooh, do you see that, Vim? Did you see that rock? Let's see if we can show you the rock from a distance. Look, the rock's moving, Vim. It's a moving rock. Here we go, the Inkahuma Pride. Now they have actually started moving distance again, which is a good thing. It means they must be getting better. And we're gonna get in a bit closer. I also saw one of the Birmingham boys. So Rexon said last night after the rain, they caught buffalo. I know they shouldn't be eating buffalo, naughty Inkahumas, but maybe the buffalo are in a bit better condition. One, two, three. So there we go. Well, they've made short work of this buffalo if they caught it last night. It's nearly done already. Ah, I know why. Because that is not the authority. That must be Tinyo. The authority is lying over there by the looks of things. So two males, all five lionesses. I'm going to do a cub count shortly, but I'm going to have to move around a bit to count the cubs because I think they're lying off at the back. So let's move out a bit. Well, there's one cub. Oh, look at that. It's one looking very fat and happy, cubby. So there's two cubs that I can see on the carcass. Sorry, guys, just need to be on the game drive for a second. Here's another one. Andrew, I've just arrived. There's all five Onesatis and two Wanunas, yeah. Hey, Vim, make your way. There we go. Munching, munching, munching. Isn't your belly a bit too big to be eating anymore, little one? That's amazing how a bit of decent meat and how quick the recovery is. A little Buddha belly there. You probably find that four of the adults are lionesses are eating now when there's so little left because of the two Birmingham boys probably dominated this carcass for the majority of the evening. Now this is about 4-5 kilometers from where we last saw them. Okay, well let's go around and see if we can see the rest of the pride. Now, oh wait, is she gonna pull the carcass? No, she was, I thought she was for a second. Now, Sammy Soccer, how are you this morning? I'm very well, nice to have you with us. Sammy would like to know, how long does it take to gain the trust of a pride that you can get close to them? Now, Sammy, I've, in all my adventures and wanderings, I'm lucky enough to have been in areas where lions have not seen vehicles and run away from them. It took me about 5 months in total till we could treat them not quite as casually as we treat the inkhorns, but we could get close enough to view them comfortably from a vehicle, even when they had cubs. At about 5 months, and that was in southern Tanzania. Okay, there we go. So there were two cubs on the carcass. Let's see if we can... Two... There we go. Three, four, five, six. So all six cubs present and accounted for. The authority with his back to us, and the fifth Nkuhuma lioness. Look at that belly. Look at you. You guys are so fat. It's okay, it's okay. Look at that waddle. My goodness. Could you be more obese, you little piggy? Well, it's good news. And hopefully these... Look at the size of that. It's like a soccer ball. Actually, all of them look like little soccer balls. Now, of course, leopard generally take a little bit longer than the lions to habituate. It's just also much easier to find lions. Tracking a pride is always easier than tracking a single animal. Tired soccer balls. They look like they've eaten so much they're actually uncomfortable. It's quite nice to see that they're moving distance again. For a long time they didn't move far at all. And the fact that all cubs have kept up with them is a good sign. Oh, everyone's full, tired. Lovely weather for them to just lounge about out in the open. No having to seek shade. Good digesting weather. Yeah, well, let's go back to the ones that are munching away on the carcass. I couldn't see. It looks like a buffalo bull, but it's quite difficult to see. Okay, so while we move back to the lions that are still munching away, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Brent has been much more successful in his search for the cats of Juma. I did find you a bird in a nest, but then it flew away, as our winged creatures do on these live safaris. Now, I'm going off gut instinct and a sort of a wish and a dream that perhaps Karula will be somewhere around this Nyala Road South area. And the biggest problem with this particular patch is that... Please repeat. Copy, I'm on my way. I think we've just missed her. Herbert says there are alarm calls at Weaver's Nest Junction Elephant Carcass, which is exactly where we were 2 seconds ago. Not 2 seconds. 10 minutes ago. That's okay, that's how it works with the Queen of Juma. If you miss your royal appointment, well, that's your fault, not hers. We're going to have to go racing through. We're a little bit further away than I would have liked. But let's see if we can't catch up with her. Hold on, everybody. It's quite a long way to go. Ah, Karula. Hopefully it's Karula. It could actually be anything. It could be a male lion. It could be this poor Dacre. It keeps running ahead of us and trying to hide, and I keep disturbing it. Shem, I'm sorry, little one. I'll try and show you it now. Ooh, maybe not. It's ducked into some very dense vegetation off to my left. Okay. No time to delay. We're going to have to go and race off to those alarm calls. For our new viewers, on a rainy day, alarm calls are often the best way of finding a cat, particularly on a rainy day. They're moving about, the animals see them, and they alert everything to their presence. Now, the alarm calls were picked up on by Herbert and Byron on foot. Let's go across to them so they can tell you all about it.
So as Jamie was mentioning how important alarm calls are to find certain predators or predators in general, we've just heard some kudu alarm calling. It sounded, it's very difficult to say or gauge exactly how far, maybe a kilometre or so south of us. So we're heading into that area. Not too sure what sighting Jamie is heading towards, but we're going to see if we can't follow up around there, and maybe we're lucky and we come across a leopard. We did have leopard tracks earlier crossing a road. So I'm thinking that these kudu have possibly spotted a leopard walking through the bush. Maybe it was Karula or heading off towards the cubs, where she left them, maybe to go and fetch them. Maybe she killed something last night. We're not sure. But that's the exciting thing, is that we don't know. It makes sense to us. It does make sense based on the weather that we've had and where Karula was yesterday. Remember I told you we actually saw her yesterday afternoon around 2 o'clock walking past the camp. We heard the impala alarm calling. Myself and VM ran out quickly and we got to see her. She disappeared though. We tried to look for her in the afternoon. We couldn't find her. And Jamie, on her way home last night, bumped into Karula lying just off the side of the road. So she'd obviously been hiding in the drainage line during the day and probably trying to get out of the rain. And then as it cleared up, she came out and perhaps hunted in that area. So we're not sure, but that it would make sense if that did happen. And now she's potentially gone and fetched the cubs and maybe heading back. Who knows? But we've had kudu alarm calls, so chances are there is a predator around there. We're just moving through quite a thick area at the moment, and it is beautiful. I'd just like to have a look at this termite mound. Termite mounds are always fantastic to go and have a look at. You might get some insect activity. Maybe there's active termites around there at the moment, especially after the rain. And while I'm walking there, this is quite interesting. See, there's a pushed over tree, and this would have been done by elephant. But what is very interesting for me is, have a look here. You can see how this is actually fairly smooth on both sides. Do you see that? Just, it looks like it's been kicked. And I wouldn't be surprised if what's happened is while the animals, I've just spotted something. Some impala just through the bushes, moving through there. Can you see them? There they go. Just heard the oxpeckers. It's always very important to listen out for oxpeckers, because they do sit on a variety of wildlife, not just antelope, but especially buffalo, and some of the larger animals we might get out here. So we do listen out for them to help us find these animals. We might not necessarily see them, but we can hear them. Getting back to this little spot that I've seen. So what I think may have happened is an animal, possibly an elephant or a hippo, walked. And as they walk, they lift their feet, but they're probably catching the side of this the stump that's been pushed over this tree. And that is because this, it does look like quite a prominent game path. Animals have walked along here. Okay, this part of the tree, and this is a knob thorn, and you can tell it, so it's a part of the acacia family, and you can actually see these very distinct knobs on the side of the tree. And this knob thorn, this part of the bark was stripped off by the elephant. It was feeding on the bark, but this over here has been kicked a few times, and I think that's possibly from animals walking over it. Another interesting thing with the knobs on this acacia tree is it has got apparently a medicinal use. Some locals would use these knobs. They would carve off a node or a knob, and they would grind it up and put it in their mouth over a tooth if they had a toothache. I've never tried it. Fortunately, I've got a dentist, but apparently it did work, so I'm not sure. But it's interesting to find these little things that people, locals, would use to help heal themselves or help cure ailments, and it's fascinating how they actually came up with these ideas and how they discovered these ideas that it helped. Apparently it did help, so it's interesting. We're going to carry on towards our termite mound. And while we head to this termite mound, Sonia, you wanted to know if we have termite problems in our camp. So, Sonia, the termites in Africa, fortunately, aren't too much of an issue because there's a lot of vegetation and that for them to feed on. But we do have to be careful, and a lot of camps do take precautions against preventing termites attacking the wood and the decks and the rooms of certain camps. I don't think we've got problems in our camp. No, we don't, not at all. So, most of our camp's built up with brick and that, but the bit of wood that is around is treated, so we don't get termites in there, and there's a lot of vegetation in that for them out here. Oh, look here. There we go. Something interesting. Beautiful millipede. Oh, that's nice. And remember I mentioned how after the rains, we probably start seeing a lot of insect activity, and these millipedes are known for being seen after a lot of rain. They do get active and they do start walking around. And these millipedes are very interesting animals, or little creatures, arthropods rather, not animals. And these millipedes actually have, and I don't want to disturb him, to turn him around, but they've got so many legs. Under the exoskeleton, they've actually got a number of pairs per segment. Now you can see clearly, let me just try to get a little stick here to point it out. But you can see the segments of the body along there. And now the millipedes actually have two or more pairs of legs per segment. And the other day we managed to find some centipedes. Now the centipedes are different, they're flatter, and also they've got one pair of legs per segment. So the millipedes are different, they'll have two or more per segment, which is very interesting. And you might be able to see, like I said, I don't want to turn him around, I don't want to disturb him, but he's got a lot of little legs. Some of them are false legs, they just follow the other legs that are working, that are moving. But they're incredibly interesting little creatures, the millipedes. That's quite a nice big one. All right, I'm going to have a look around this termite mound briefly, see if I can find something. If not, we're going to carry on towards those alarm calls that we had. And speaking of alarm calls, let's head to Jamie and get an update from her.
We have raced across in the direction of those alarm calls. Now, Herbie tells me on the Game Drive channel that it was kudu alarm calling. Now, that's really important information for me because I need to know what animal to look for in terms of the alarm calls so that I know roughly whereabout they came from, because I didn't hear them myself, so it's a little bit more tricky trying to follow up on them. Our kudu gives off a deep booming buh, buh, kind of a bark. It's the loudest bark of any antelope, and it travels particularly far. Luckily, I did actually notice some kudu not too far, not too far away from that battalia when we were there earlier, and I couldn't get them on camera because they were just too far away. But it gives us a good idea. There could also be other kudu around, but it gives us a good idea as to where to start. So let's once more drive elephant carcass very, very slowly. That's the road, name of the road, by the way. It's not an actual elephant carcass, it's just the name of the road. So if my memory serves, the kudu were right in this dense, dense vegetation off to my left. I don't see them anymore. Could well mean that she's managed to catch something and she's on her way south to fetch the cubs. That's what I'm hoping for, because it'll mean that she's going to constantly keep moving. She's not hidden, and that is a good thing because it increases our chances of finding her and also increases our chances of other animals seeing her and giving the alarm. I agree, Liz. I also really enjoy kudu. So Liz has raised the point that kudu don't really mess around when they're alarm calling. They don't alarm at anything really, except for leopards, lions, and cheetah. So that really does give us a nice starting base point. We can really trust them. We can work on the assumption that they are one of the most trustworthy sources, if you want to call them that, of information in the bush. Things like impala, often there is a false alarm and they start to bark, and then because that herding instinct is so strong within them, they all start to do it. And then they're all looking around in confusion going, what? Why am I alarm calling? Ah! 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 I don't know what's going on. So kudu are definitely more reliable. They're slightly taller, which actually really helps in terms of a vantage point in something like an impala. They're also used to living in dense vegetation. So their eyesight is particularly, their sort of perception of movement is a particularly Karula. I just missed you. That's the way of the world. These are wild animals, and as a result, not always exactly where you expect them to be. I'm just gonna, it's just a chance, just take a chance and go in to this area where she was before. Let's see if she's not around here. It's one of her favorite spots. She was here twice in 1 week with Brent and her kill. Now let's just check it. Karula. Ah, well. It was a nice thought. But no luck. I'm also listening now if she is moving for that. That's exactly what I'm listening for. Squirrel alarm calls. That was a frantic one as well. Where is the squirrel? Squirrels are also false alarmers. They alarm call at snakes, leopards, lions, other squirrels, their reflection, a leaf blowing in the wind. Any excuse to make a racket, they will take. I suppose it makes sense. You've got to be a lot more afraid of things if you're a lot smaller. That squirrel just went crazy and then went quiet again. I wonder if we've just missed her crossing the road. Let's just listen for 1 second. I just want to listen to the sounds of the bush. Might hopefully give her position away. Squirrel? What was that all about? Okay. Which way to go? South, I think. We don't have much else to go on, so we'll go on the assumption that she's going south to fetch cubs, and I hope that that pays off. Go back the other way around. Yeah, kudu, this is right. Kudu, you can trust. Squirrels, not so much. Actually, all members of the antelope family, the spiral-horned antelope family, kudu, bushbuck, nyala, tend to be probably your most reliable source of information. And the other interesting thing, of course, for our new viewers, there is one species, that one predator, that no animal even bothers to alarm call about. And that is wild dog. The animals don't even waste their energy standing, looking, and calling. They know if they've got that cat in their sight, they're alarm calling to warn everybody else, but they know they're not in danger because it's not the cat you see that gets you most of the time. But when a wild dog pack comes running through, they race off. They don't stop to think, they just run. And you've just got to run faster than your neighbor when it comes to wild dogs. The cisticulas are alarm calling now. Sometimes they alarm call for leopards. Karula. No. They're just chirping. I'm going to make sure that we don't go racing off and miss her because we've been going too fast. There's a boo-boo. There's two boo-boos in that tree. That's a bird we don't often get to see. And can you see them there? They're in that. They're jumping around in that bush willow. In that tree. Try going a little bit higher. There-ish. They moved into that thick stuff. There we go. Saw movement there. Hopping up. There we go. Perfect. Thank you. A southern boo-boo. Which sounds like something you get when you're a kid, when you graze your knee or your elbow. It is spelt B-O-U-B-O-U. A southern boo-boo. And we hardly ever get to see them. Cool. A really nice one for those of you who are budding birders to add to your bird list. We've come through into the middle of a bird feeding party. Now, Mary, you wanted to know, there's one there at the bottom, Gert, it's just a little bit low, it's hopping around, slightly clearer, there we go, thank you. You wanted to know if these are migratory birds. They are not. They are a bird that stays with us all year round. They're just very secretive. We don't often see them outside. You can see how they're hopping in the really thick leaves. They are a bird species that's quite shy, much like our bushshrikes, our grey-headed bushshrike, our orange-breasted bushshrike, and of course they are related to them. And that means that they are quite hidden birds, they're quite secretive birds, so we hardly ever get to see them. That was wonderful. Well done, Gert, for managing to get them on camera. Not often that we do. I was hoping they were going to call for you, but they seem to be relatively silent. So you want to know how to spell boo-boo. It is not spelled like the boo-boo that you get when you're a child, when you fall down. It is spelled B-O-U-B-O-U. And this is the southern boo-boo. I admit it's a funny name. There are funnier in the bird world, but I won't go down that road. Let's just say that the southern boo-boo is a relatively normal name in birding terms. The southern boo-boo. There he is. Yes, well done. Oh, might be the longest southern boo-boo sighting I've ever had. The more you say it, the weirder the name starts to sound. Like our black-bellied bustards. Wonderful. Well done, Gert. Let's go look for Karula now. And Honey Ocelot, you want to know if they make, if we can make a boo-boo call. Somewhat frustratingly, I can't think of exactly how it goes. It's a whistle, and it's a beautiful whistle, and if I heard it immediately, I'd be able to tell you that that was a boo-boo. Perhaps if we ask Brent really nicely at some point during the safari, he might play you a boo-boo call on his birding app. So that you can hear what a boo-boo sounds like. They don't say boo-boo. So the name, I'm actually not 100% sure where the name comes from. I don't know why they're called boo-boos. There are a couple of different boo-boos. There are a couple of different species of boo-boos. We only get the one here. So we'll have to ask Brent to play you the southern boo-boo call, unless Byron thinks he can do a good impression of it, but I can't think of it off the top of my head. It's a nice whistling call. Now, I told you the birds would all be out and about and happy now that the rain has fallen. They know that the insects are going to be all over the show. They're going to be happy little birds. There we go. Aaron has named one of the boo-boo species. Aaron, you want to know if we see the tropical boo-boos. The tropical boo-boos on Juma. Sorry, it's sounding weirder the more I say it. We don't get the tropical boo-boos on Juma. They're much more based in the sort of riverine areas. Even the southern boo-boo likes the denser vegetation. But the tropical boo-boos, not here, unfortunately. Also very, I think, very pretty birds. speaking of Brent, and of course, first thing in the morning of breakfast, let's go across to him so he can share the lion sighting with you.
Well, Tenure just rushed in and chased the lionesses off the kill. Now he's greeting them. Now it's going to be interesting to see if Mfumo responds to this. One of the lionesses has dragged the kill a bit further away. Also, one of them is sporting quite a nasty gash on her left shoulder. It looks like a buffalo horn wound, but nothing too serious. It doesn't look like it punctured the rib cage. It just looks like a superficial flesh wound. Okay, let's see what Mr. Tenure is up to. Is he going to chase them again? Oh, he's got a bit of a limp, probably from fighting with Mfumo. You can actually see, it looks like he's got a bite on his foot. There you go. Oh, Amber Eyes is greeting him. Oh, grumpy. Now, Mfumo's head's up. We can't see him from where we are, but... Oh! Now, this is completely normal behavior. Oh, look at this. Oh, there we go. Still up. Mfumo is definitely still the authority. Okay, let's just try to get around. And you can hear all the cubs now getting in. Isn't that incredible? Now that is very common when there's two male lions in the same place, especially around a carcass, especially with lots of cubs and females around. Ooh, where's that landmine, Liam? I don't... So when I refer to a landmine, I of course refer to lion dung. It's not something you want to drive around over and keep the smell with you for the rest of the day. So you can definitely see that Mfumo is still the authority of these two males. He's also got a limp. They've probably been going at each other a few times already this evening and this morning. Okay. I'm just trying to think. He's growling again. He might go at the lioness as she tries to sneak towards the carcass. He's just asserting dominance. He might tolerate one of the cubs on the carcass. There we go. Oh, the cub doesn't want to tolerate him on the carcass. So all the lions are quite spread after that little tiff. Now, on lion standards, that wasn't a big fight. That was a small one. And the one we saw a few weeks ago was about a medium-sized fight. So none of these have been proper, serious lion fights. Everything's calmed down a bit. one's quite spread out, but it does look like the blood is slowly coming down to a simmer rather than a boil. Not sure which lioness has got the gash in her left shoulder. It doesn't look like that one. Is it that one? Difficult to see from this angle, but it just looks like a horn hooked her, but just a superficial flesh injury. Look at the cub. He's trying to get licked at the same time Mom is trying to clean herself. Lick me, please. Clean me, Mom. Please. No, Mom. Me, please. There we go. Sleepy cub perched on the termite mound. Hi, Jenny. Jenny would like to know, does the fighting frighten the cubs? Or do they just get excited? Jenny said, I would say it's a bit of both. Just, Vim, come on to the carcass, just in case he decides to chase that lioness who snuck up. I'd say it does frighten them. They do move away, but they also do get excited in the aftermath, and that's when they all start trying to roar, make noise. Let's see what happens here. See if he growls at her. See how very, very tentatively she's approaching the carcass. Okay, well, we're going to stay here, see what happens in this interesting interaction. While we do that, Jamie's got the smallest carnivore in the whole of Africa.
Look what we've just found. Tiny, tiny baby dwarf mongoose. They probably only just started venturing out of the safety of the burrow with their adults. And this is such a perfect time. You never get to see this. Oh, this is too special for words. Oh, little ones, the smallest of the carnivores that we get out here. Oh, he was so cute. And to see the babies is a very special sighting indeed, especially this young. I'm making a sort of a generic squeak that mongoose often respond to just because they're very bright and very curious. And just like that, that's probably the... Oh no, there's another little one. It'll come through into sight in a moment. These babies are so tiny, they would fit into the palm of my hand. The dwarf mongoose, the adult dwarf mongoose, is probably about half the size of my forearm and only a couple of grams. But the babies, oh my goodness. Wait, there's one that's gonna follow the other back into the hole. They're there, they're all crowded around it, they're checking that it's safe. There's you'll see the little baby in a second. It's just hidden behind that termite mound. It's being groomed by one of the adults, I think. Hi guys, the smallest carnivore on Juma, mammalian carnivore that is. Oh, where's this little baby gone now? And as I said, it is really unusual to see baby dwarf mongoose. And you know what's amazing? This is the same group. There it is. It's just popped out now. There we go. Hi, little one. It's not much bigger than a hamster. In fact, it is. It's hamster size. It's a big hamster size. And back in. That's why we had to rush you across, because you never get to see them, and they only come out in the morning in the sort of first initial stages of their adventures away from the burrow, so that they can be groomed by mom, so that they can be suckled. Oh, this is special. Let's go over to Byron and see what he's got.
Look what we found, everyone. Remember I said having a look at Termite Mounds, and that is crucial at the moment. You might get a lot of activity. Now, I found something. I've hit a complete blank. It's not quite a snake, but it's... It's a blind, I think, what are they called? Blind beaked snake, or I think they do fall under the snake family. They do indeed, but now I can't remember, and I've hit a complete blank. I will look it up as soon as I get back. I can't believe I've forgotten what these are. I've seen a few of them before. But isn't this interesting? Now, I don't know what it's doing. I don't know if it's managed to find something in there that it's trying to kill, or if it's trying to come back out or get in. I'm not sure. It hasn't been moving in or out. But isn't this fascinating? It is a species of snake. It's definitely a species of snake, but I just can't remember what they're called again. Oh, you see what happens when you sometimes get used to seeing things, and then when interesting creatures like this pop out, you forget what they are. And I've drawn a complete blank. Yes, so it is definitely a blind snake. And Steph's watching in the FC at the moment. Yeah, so exactly. Like I said, it's this blind snake, but I'm not sure which one. But maybe a Schlegel's blind snake. This is fascinating. Look at that. I wonder what it's trying to do in here. Oh, this is so cool. This is so different. Something very, very unique and different that we don't get to see often. And these are the types of animals you could expect to see after rain. Because the soil's a lot softer, and a lot of these blind snakes burrow a lot. And when the soil is soft like this, then it's easier for them to move around and burrow. But I wonder, I think it's trying to get away. I think it's trying to squeeze in there. And that is fascinating. Some of these little blind snakes have got a bit of a hinge on the nostril, or not quite the nostril, but on the mouth and the nose, that they're able to dig and burrow very, very well. I was hoping it'd come out for us. Have a look, maybe. So we can see that head. Because they are very, very different looking. And I wonder if it's not trying to eat something. I wonder if it didn't chase something in there, into this hole. Isn't this fascinating? This is so interesting to see. I'm trying to listen to see if I can hear anything. It does sound like it's eating something. Now, Omkar, you asked if it's venomous. Some of these blind snakes do have a bit of venom. But I don't think anything that we need to be worried about. I think they're mildly venomous, and they use venom to catch whatever they are eating, but I don't think we need to worry about it. Interesting behavior. Anyway, I'm going to sit around there for a while and see if it does come out. If it does come out, I'll get you back to have a look at it. But in the meantime, let's head back to Jamie with some baby dwarf mongoose.
This is absolutely Amazing. I think we might be witness to one of the first forays of these little baby dwarf mongoose into the open. And the poor adults are rushing around like mad things trying to collect them. And every time they grab one and put it back in the hole, another one comes dashing out. There we go. She's carrying it back to the hole now. She's got one. She's carrying it back. And now she's going to drop it in. And then as soon as she turns her back, they come running out again. Oh, these poor parents. Of course, the whole family of dwarf mongoose is devoted to looking after these babies. And so only the alpha pair will breed. And the rest of the... Look, see, escape, escapee. And it's out again. Ooh, not quite brave enough. I think it's going to go back. There it is. Oh, this is such a big, wide and exciting world. And there's at least four of them that are roughly the size of hamsters. Here we go. They're going to be collected. Oh, no, now there's another one escaping. Oh, dear. You've got to have eyes in the back of your head if you're a mongoose. Oopsie. Oh, dear. Someone took a tumble. Oh, my goodness. You know what? I shouldn't have favorites, but you won't believe this. This is the same mongoose family that we saw so long ago with the cobra that had... I'm sorry, I have to laugh. It's just too cute. That cobra that had come slithering through, and we watched them for ages as the adults transferred the young. And Mind Warp, you apparently were talking about the time we saw them. They were carrying their babies from one spot to another. It was truly one of the most extraordinary dwarf mongoose sightings I have had to date. Mind Warp, this is the same group. I know because they live. This is exactly where that sighting was. So almost with certainty, I'll tell you that it's exactly the same family of mongoose. How cool is that? This is the small. These are the smallest baby dwarf mongoose I have ever, ever, ever seen. The whole world is so exciting. They're like little kittens, almost, exploring their world. Oh, this is too special. This is not a sight that you see every day. And just a reminder to our new viewers, another one's going in, all going in. This is live, so it is all happening right here and right now. And we've got a collection of baby mongoose jumping around and playing. It is extraordinary. And if you do have any questions that you would like to ask, you could send those through on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. I'm just trying to think. Sorry, give me a second. I'm trying to think of the name for a baby dwarf mongoose. We discussed it not too long ago. And I can't remember, should we decide it was a pup or was it a kit? It's not a kit, it's a pup, I think. Dwarf mongoose pups. I mean, these are relatively arbitrary terms that are applied, but they do have official names. I'm just trying to remember. Oh, it's because the baby mongoose have turned my brains into mush. Promise you, I've never seen anything like this. It's so early for them to be out. And I really think this might be one of their first explorations. Oh, you're getting so brave. Some of them have run right away from the burrow. Some of them not so brave. Others are almost invisible now. If you go in a little bit, Gert, you should see one there just off to the... There we go, the adult's going to fetch it. And back. Oh, these poor adults. You know what? I think there might be... maybe I'm crazy, but I keep seeing one that looks slightly larger than the others, which is quite unusual. Oh, they're suckling now. No. I thought for a second perhaps Mom had come to feed them. It would be very unusual to see two generations of babies. Oh! All rushing around... These poor adults have got their work cut out for them. It's worse than herding wet cats. All the while being watched by a hornbill. It's watching the comings and goings with a very stately air. Oh, got you. And back to the burrow, back to the burrow, back to the burrow with you. Go back home. And stay home. Ah, but now, the adult's got its work cut out for it again, because there's still one that's left out. So as soon as she leaves it, the others are going to escape again. Sorry, Rebecca, I was so distracted by what was happening in front of me, I didn't even hear the question. Ferrati wanted to know what the dwarf mongoose feed on. They feed on insects. They're mainly insectivorous. They can also catch things like reptiles. Sometimes they feed off frogs, amphibians. And we only get the dashing across. I'm sorry. I'm so distracted. I can't stop watching them. Okay, I think all of the babies have been netted. That's a teenager, so that's probably one from a previous litter. I think that's why I was seeing a larger one. Our dwarf mongoose are carnivores that are particularly specialized. They're very good at catching and killing scorpions, and they're very good at digging them out as well. They've got long, fierce claws and razor-sharp little teeth, and I promise you the teeth are razor-sharp. I know, because I've been bitten by one. They are razor-sharp. And off we go. And I think... No, I'm not even going to do that because I feel too guilty for the poor parents. They've just managed to get the kids to bed. Let's not wake them up again. That was awesome. The adults have finally managed to gather all the little ones, get them into the hole, stay in the hole. Aaron... I remember looking this up the last time we had a baby dwarf mongoose sighting. I'm trying to remember what the gestation period is. I know that they have on average, they have between 2 to 6 babies each time, and that by around about 8 months they are fully mature, and in fact I think they're actually sexually mature by around 8 months old. The gestation period is, I think it's just a couple of weeks. Round about 3. I'll double check in a second and just remind myself exactly what it was. It's a short gestation period, which means that the female can often have several litters in 1 year. Several litters of pups. Oh, that was incredible. And you see how all animals do this, and I'm not sure whether or not you noticed. Now, I've had friends in the past that have... There we go. It's just over 4 weeks. Okay, it's just over 4 weeks. 49 to 53 days is the gestation period of the dwarf mongoose. But what was fascinating about that is the natural reflex that all baby animals out here show. When you grab them by the back of the neck and you lift them up, not that I would advise going around grabbing things by the back of the neck and lifting them up, but when the parents do, the babies tuck, curl, and go completely limp. They don't fight. They don't struggle, they just know. And that's lion cubs, leopard cubs, baby mongoose. I have seen baby wildcat kittens before. Wildcat kittens, let's not be superfluous here. I've seen wildcat kittens before, and I've been able to be part of their rehabilitation, picking them up, grabbing them by the loose skin on the back of the neck, because when they are utterly chaotic and you're trying to gather them together, the only way to get them to relax is to lift them up by the back loose patch of skin. And they just do this. They could have been tearing around with teeth and claws, but as soon as you pick them up there, they just do that. It's incredibly instinctive. Cool. That was so much fun. I think, unfortunately, they're gone. Anna Marie, I have, as I said, these are the first baby dwarf mongoose I've never seen a dwarf mongoose this young. You wanted to know whether or not they are born with teeth, because of course hyena cubs are, and certain animals are not. My suspicion is no, that they will erupt within a couple of days, but I'm not 100% sure on that. I'll have to try and find out for you, Anna Marie. Or perhaps actually I can ask you guys if baby dwarf mongoose are born with fully erupted teeth or if they erupt after a couple of days. That was awesome. We might not have found Karula just yet, but we did find something really cool. And speaking of really cool things and really cool people, let's go back over to Brent.
Well, Amber and the youngest lioness have been quite flirty with Mr. Tenyo, and they've moved a little bit away from the rest of the pride. And I'm wondering if the authority, I'm just gonna try to get into a spot where I can see where he last was, whether the authority might not take exception to this and come charging through the bush. So the authority is lying off about 50, 60 meters away. And Tenyo has followed the ladies to cheetah cut line, or two of the ladies that don't have cubs. Now, we have seen Amber Eyes mating and the youngest lioness mating, and they haven't, Amber did start sort of showing signs of pregnancy a while ago, but maybe due to health conditions she might have aborted, and it's difficult to say why she hasn't had cubs yet, and she might have a problem with her ovaries. It's very difficult to say. Not all matings always immediately end in cubs. Quite often, a lot of them don't. So, and also the youngest lioness, she's still a little young. Well, even though she's having estrous cycles, they normally have their first set of cubs at about 4. So she's still got a way to go. They can have them earlier. They are sexually mature from just over 2. But generally, it seems that lions have their cubs a little later. Now, it all depends on the individual, and we don't know what's happening inside Amber Eyes, but I'm hoping she will have cubs at some point. Now, Tenyo, are you going to get yourself another smack from the authority by hanging out with the ladies? Now, as Michael says, disputes amongst coalition members are very common in male lions. And Michael's wondering, he says it seems that Tenyo and Mfumo fight more than normal. And why does Tenyo always seem to be in a bad mood? Michael, I don't think they fight more than normal at all. I just think because of the extended period we've been spending with the pride, we're seeing these interactions more often. Now, some of the biggest fights, lion fights I've ever seen over mating rights, were in the Sabi Sands, and were over with the coalition called the Mapocho, and between two, so a lot of people thought they had an unusually special bond. I personally disagree, and I spent a lot of time with those lions, which was between Kinky Tail and Mr. T. I've seen them absolutely beat the living daylights out of each other when it comes to mating rights, and really much more seriously than we've ever seen Mfumo and Tenyo go at it, and on multiple occasions. So it's normal for coalition members to fight. You get sand in your nose, little one. Sneeze, sneeze. Or have you got a buffalo hairball coming? Oh. No. Shame. Everything seems a lot more calm now. I'm just trying to remember, who can tell me the last date we saw any of either of these two lionesses mating? I'd really, really be interested to know. I think it must be close on 2 months ago, maybe. If that's the case, they should be coming to estrus again quite soon. So it's going to be fascinating to see. I think it is a hairball. Shame. Or is it hiccups? Lion hiccups. Vim, give her a fright quickly. Maybe that'll help. Remember, this is 100% live. And if you want to ask questions about the lion hiccups or the hairball, you can send the questions through to the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or use the email address questions@wildearth.tv. Looks like hiccups. Her tail's starting to swing, meaning she's getting irritated with hiccups. There we go, she's up now. You see those scars on her side? Well, no, she hasn't quite got rid of them yet. Hi, Ryan. Ryan is 10 years old. And it's great to have you with us again, Ryan. Ryan would like to know, how many cubs can a lion have in a single litter? Well, the most ever recorded in the wild, I think, was 6 or 7 in Nairobi National Park in Kenya. Normally, it's anything from 1 to 4. In captivity, there's been some abnormal birthings, but that could just be because of inbreeding and all sorts of other terrible things, of over 12 cubs in a litter. But normally, 1 to 4 would be average, and two or three is the norm. Yeah, well, these guys are all flat on the road. Now let's go back to the carcass and see what's happening there. Well, isn't this incredible? What a find by Byron, the Schlieblen's blind burrowing snake. And apparently it's trying to make its escape, so let's go look.
So it does look like this blind snake is moving back into the termite mound. I'm not too sure what it was doing, unless it was feeding onto, I really have no idea, and we couldn't see inside, so I'm not sure. Or maybe it chased an insect in there and was after it and trying to catch it. But it does seem to have been moving quite a way in there now, and possibly lives inside this termite mound. But what an interesting little creature. I mean, that really is fascinating. I'm so glad we got to see it. It was fascinating to watch for a while. But we're going to leave it alone, not disturb it, and carry on our walk, see what else we can find. And, oh. James Bear, you want to know how large it is. So judging by what we saw, and I couldn't see the head, but James, it looks like it was about that length, which is fairly large for a blind snake. So about that length, I would think. Like I said, I couldn't see how much of it was in the hole when we found it, but I think it about that long. So fairly large blind snake, and it's only about that thick. So not too thick. And it was interesting, occasionally it would flatten the body out a little bit, trying to maneuver and make its way into that termite mound. Very, very interesting. Let's see what else we can find. See, and that's what I said, having a look at these termite mounds and after the rain, just after the rain in general, is a great idea, because you never know what you're going to find. You're going to find interesting animals like that that probably aren't as active during the rest of the year, but after rain probably become very active. I'm surprised we haven't found any fresh aardvark diggings, actually. Speaking of animals that get active after the rain, and we do know there are aardvark on Juma, and we've seen their tracks, we've seen the diggings before, and I would have thought that I might bump into a few areas where they've been digging looking for termites after the rain, but nothing just yet. He's still walking around. We're trying to follow up or listen out for those alarm calls again that we had. And we managed to find the kudu that were alarm calling. So we're in that area where we first heard them call, but no sign of any predators just yet. So maybe they saw something, maybe they smelled something. Not too sure. But we've had a good look around here and I don't see any sign. We haven't heard any alarm calls again. And we've been here for quite some time and we've been very quiet. So if they did see anything, maybe it moved through the area and moved out of the area quite quickly. If it was the female leopard we're looking for, Karula. It's wonderful weather to be walking in at the moment. Nice and cool, which is really, really great. It's always better to walk when it's cool as opposed to when it's very, very warm. Now, I can hear, it sounded like a squirrel. I just want to hear carefully. Coming from the drainage line behind me. And of course, it seems to have stopped. No, there is a squirrel alarm calling down in the drainage line. Now, I know Jamie mentioned it earlier that you can't necessarily always trust a squirrel. I think they are a bit paranoid at times because I've seen squirrels alarm calling standing on the edge of a branch, alarm calling at absolutely nothing. But, you know, perhaps it saw something. Maybe it didn't. We can always just go and have a look down there. Always, when you are moving towards these drainage lines, you've got to be careful because you could have animals that are moving around through the thicker areas. You've got to look very carefully and listen out if you do hear anything moving through the thickets. And while we go and investigate the squirrel alarm call, let's head over to Jamie.
Well, it's not Jamie, it's Brent. And only one lioness feeding on what little is left of the buffalo. She actually looks like she's eating the stomach lining. But I think most of the action, and what action we've had here this morning, has played out. And I think for the last 40 minutes or so, we're going to go meander around, see what else we can find. Maybe we can add a bird or two to your bird lists, or maybe we might stumble upon the Queen of Juma, Karula. But it has been excellent, as spending time with the Nkahumas always is. And everyone else has gone to sleep, and this lioness is getting her last bit of sustenance from this buffalo carcass. Anna Marie is wondering whether the cat streak continues. It indeed does, Anna Marie. Day 77. Aren't we lucky? Lots and lots of big cats all over the place. We're being thoroughly spoiled. And I think we must make hay while the sun shines, because the more it rains, the more the big cats are going to spread out as they follow their chosen prey species. Okay, Nkahumas, it's been great, it's been grand, it's been spectacular, it's been growly, it's been snarly, it's been bloody, it's been beautiful. Let's move along. And there we go, I'll give you one last look there. All the cubs and the lionesses and the authority flat cats. Hello, Marsha. Now, Marsha's wondering, with those fat bellies, how long is it going to be before the lions need to feed again? Marsha, I think they'll hunt again, if not tonight, tomorrow. Now, the reason for that is that the lionesses aren't nearly as full as the males and the cubs. So the males have dominated that carcass. And I think there would have been a lot of aggression last night once that kill was made, or if the Gumas made it without the males being present when the males arrived. And also aggression between the two males. So I think the girls are still slightly peckish and hopefully they might hunt again this evening or tomorrow morning. Tomorrow night, almost definitely. And there's Mr. Tenyo with his two consorts. Be careful, Mr. Tenyo. The authority will get you. Okay. I was going to go to the right, but now since there are lions across the road, I'll go to the left. Oh, we've still got those elephant tracks. Let's see where they go. And hopefully it'll lead to some alleys, maybe some birds. But what a spectacular morning so far. Just amazing, that impressive power. Even though that was a very minor male lion fight, it is incredible. Now we're going to continue searching for everything and anything out here in the African bush. Now, Jamie has found something that can't run away from you.
That's very true. The tree is not going to run away at all. Oh, a little bit earlier when I stopped here to have a look, I think Rebecca was somewhat perplexed by my studying of this particular tree, and she wasn't quite sure exactly what it is we were looking for. And this particular tree is the home of a red-billed... what are they called? Hornbill. A red-billed hornbill nest. And the reason I'm sitting here, I've stopped to wait, is just to see whether or not the male comes in with the next meal for his brood. Now, the hole is situated in the dead tree itself. But the base is quite low. It's quite close to the base. It's around there that I first saw him feeding his little ones. They must be on the other side. There must be a hollow on the other side. And I was hoping that this red-billed hornbill dad might return and start feeding them for you. Because, of course, the red-billed or all hornbill females, when they do nest, they are entirely dependent upon the actions of the male. So she loses her flight feathers and she holds herself up inside wherever she happens to be nesting. And she basically sits there to keep the chicks warm and waits for him to bring her food each and every single time. I saw him earlier. I think he's struggling today to find some food. Let's go see if we can find him. I'm sure we'll find him. He doesn't go far because obviously the further he goes, the further he's got to trek back with the food concerned. Just a quick finishing or rounding up of that mongoose sighting. That was absolutely amazing, but what was more incredible, after we left, we stayed for a couple of minutes just to see what they were going to do. They were left with babysitters, which is very typical mongoose behavior, or her pestered behavior. And essentially, the adults go off foraging, and they leave often the sub-adults to do the babysitting. These poor sub-adults looked a little bit, in my anthropomorphic opinion, they looked a little bit overwrought. A little bit stressed out with the level of responsibility that they had been given. And it immediately reminded me of many, many years ago working in the Southern Kalahari. The closest town to where I was a place called Kuruman. And in the Southern Kalahari, there are meerkats, and we were sort of one of the programs that the reserve ran was research into these meerkats, and they'd become very comfortable with people. And of course, a meerkat is basically a desert mongoose. Where do you do? I'm not looking for you, I'm looking for a red-billed hornbill. It's a go-away bird, by the way. I don't know where he's gone. I don't know where Karula's gone either. But in the desert, these meerkats, we went there first thing in the morning, and they had three gorgeous little babies that were suckling from mom. And then the adults went off to go about their daily business, and the sub-adults stayed with the babies to look after them that evening. And it's very clear to see in red Kalahari sand, this massive track going straight in to one of the holes in the ground. And there was this enormous puff adder. Oh, look at this. Look, 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 look. It's being mobbed. Sorry, hold that thought. One very miserable looking eagle. I think it's our dark morph Warburgs, that very square tail, quite a small bird, so it is our dark morph Warburgs eagle. Oh, Drongo's gone. Well done, Warburgs, you managed to weather the storm. It was being chased away by a little black bird known as a fork-tailed Drongo. You see, these rainy days or these gloomy days have so much in the way of exciting things to offer. I'll finish my meerkat story in a moment. Let's just see if any of the drongos come back. Now, it's not, sorry, that's my fault again. I've forgotten how to take my foot off the brake. It's not hard. This Warburg's pair, there's a dark morph and a pale morph pair of them. There you can see the crest being blown up a little bit. Very distinctive on a Warburg's eagle. That and the dark eye and the small size of this particular bird are usually the dead giveaways. So unlike our two pale morph Warburgs a little further north, this is a mixed couple. A light morph or pale morph Warburgs and this dark morph Warburgs. I'm not sure which is which. I'm not sure which is the male and which is the female. But I do really long to see the chicks that they raise. I'd love to see the genetics. Because pale morphs, the average form, the sort of normal colour of a Warburg's eagle is a sort of a tawny colour. The dark morphs are about 10% of the population and the pale morphs are about 10% of the population. Which makes it most likely a recessive gene. So I would love to know what kind of babies the two of them are going to produce, what colour they're going to be, if they're just going to be normal. They shouldn't really be normal, should they? I don't know, I'm not quite sure exactly how recessive the gene is or if it's a sort of a dual expression gene or something like that. I have to research it a little bit further. Looking very miserable, very likely be the reason for the alarm calls from the squirrels. Emily, you wanted to know if there's a place that you can get for the area. Emily, that's a very good point. I'm just trying to think.
So we're walking around at the moment and just having a look. We thought we saw a track of a female leopard crossing the road, and we're just trying to have a look through this drainage line. But what I have come across, something interesting within this little tree. Oh, hang on. Now look at these beautiful egg casings. Isn't that fascinating? Very bright, shiny little egg casings. I'm not too sure what it is from, though. However, I mean, you can see there's been caterpillar feeding on around the leaves, the edge of the leaves around here. You can see that, or perhaps beetles. Now, I'm trying to see, get a clear shot of view of some of these beetles. There are some beetles on this tree, and I'm not sure what species of beetle. There's a nice clump there. Otherwise, let me just look here. They're all over, actually. Tiny little shiny, shiny beetles. Can you see them there, Jean-André? Yeah. And it's tricky with the wind, yeah. Maybe I'll try and hold it steady for you. But very, very beautiful. And those might be those beetles might be the ones that laid those eggs just over here. It's interesting. It's amazing if you just stop and have a look at these little trees and bushes around. There's always something on them. It's really, really interesting. It's a beautiful bird calling. And a few of them around. The little brown crown shagras. And one's just called off to the side. I'll see if we hear it again. Beautiful call. It's wonderful to stand and stop looking at the bushes, seeing what you find on here, and having all these birds call around you. There's some beautiful birds I'd just like to show you quickly. And they're just up at the top of that tree, fluttering around. There are two of them. There goes the other one. Oh, it's just flown off. Little chin spot batters. Got it. Beautiful little chin spot batters, and you can hear them calling. Got them, just flew off there. Wonderful, isn't that? Little chin spot batters. It's so nice walking around these drainage lines, these thicker areas. There's a lot of trees, a lot of bird life and activity going on around here. You can hear all these wonderful birds calling, and those little chin spot batters is only about this big, very, very small birds, but a beautiful call. You can hear them still calling in the distance. And let's see. I'm going to carry on checking just to see if we can't find more signs of that leopard that we had walking around here. I'm going to check the drainage line. While we do that, let's head back to Brent for an update on the lions.
Well, hopefully Byron and Jamie get some luck with Karula, and we're going to head not too far away from there. You never know, she might pop up, but we're going to try to do some birds. And I know Jamie asked very nicely if I would play a call for you, the call of the southern boo-boo, and I shall indeed. It is a very beautiful call. I'm just checking Karula didn't come this way. Oh no, that's a swamp boo-boo. We don't get those here. We get the southern boo-boo. And I hold it here. We're hearing it. Oh no, I pushed the wrong button. That was my fault. So there we go. Now, there's normally an answer. There we go. Isn't that cool? Boop, boop, boop. So that's two different birds. And then boop, boop, boop. That's the answer. There we go again. Very, very cool. Now they've got lots of different calls. And Jamie did mention we don't get the tropical boo-boo here. Just to the north of us, along the Limpopo River, there's actually a hybrid between the tropical and southern, which is very unusual, and it only in that area where the two species overlap. But we're well too far south for that. And there we go, the call of the southern boo-boo. Maybe we'll see a southern boo-boo around the Mawati River. Now, we have seen black cuckoos this wet season so far. We've seen quite a few of them, and they have that wonderfully mournful call. I'm so sad. And the reason you often find them in areas where you have southern boo-boos is that their favorite brood, they're the brood parasites of the southern boo-boo. So they actually look for areas where southern boo-boos occur in numbers, and the black cuckoos will hang around there trying to find where the boo-boos nest. Now, southern boo-boos are monogamous, and they stay paired for life. Unfortunately for them, they do end up raising quite a few black cuckoo chicks over their lifetime. Now also, I forgot, Jamie was mentioning the longest traveling kingfisher migrant, and she was spot on correct. It is indeed the woodlands kingfisher that migrates all the way from Marichuana, Chad, that part of the world. And the second longest is the pygmy kingfisher that comes from as far as Somalia. Nicole. Nicole's wondering if we get any birds here in Juma that migrate from North America. Not to my knowledge. I'm just trying to think. No. Off the coast, wow, there's a big group of Inyala. And a big pig. Where's that pig? He's hiding. You see him, Vim? Oh, he's running. Oh, is he running or is he hiding? There's a big grey bottom through there somewhere. Let's see if I go back a bit. There he is. Hello, big pig. Oh, no, big pig's off. Now, we haven't seen any baby pigs just yet. Let's just go forward for the Inyala. Nice group of Inyala. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, about 10, 11. And unfortunately, they're moving into the monkey orange thickets. Careful, Karula likes hiding in monkey orange thickets, you lot. Okay, they're moving off. So, off the coast, especially the west coast of Africa. We do get, off the coast, we'll probably get some migrants that come from off the North American coast as well. Sorry, I just, no, vulture, but flying far away. So possibly Prince Marian Island down towards the Antarctic. We might get some migrants from North America. Actually, no, I lie, but I'm not sure whether they migrate from North America. I'm going to have to double check for you. I think the Red Shank might come from North America, and maybe some of the Godwits. No, I'm absolutely lying. We do on the coast, not here. Your Pacific Golden Plovers, they all come from North America. Silly Brent, naughty. Of course we do. We do get migrants, not here in Juma, but on the coastal areas and around large bodies of water. Now, I can see Jamie up ahead on the road, but apparently she's got something she's been looking for, but it's hiding from her.
Waving hello to Brent. We did. We found something that has been hiding from us, and Brent was about to find it, but we got here first. We'll show you the Speke's Hinge tortoise that now, unfortunately, much like Brent's Inyala, has moved off into a rather prickly position, and is now doing exactly the same thing as Brent's tortoise from earlier, pretending that we can't see it and it can't see us. Just the view of its back feet sticking out. A Speke's Hinged tortoise. Funnily enough, the Speke's Hinged tortoise doesn't actually have a hinge on its shell, unlike some of the other hinged tortoises. Hello.
Hello.
Okay, so you've checked Mumba Road now.
Yes, I have checked Mumba Road.
Okay.
No sign of her.
I have a feeling I've just been missing her. I think we've been driving around. We've been just missing each other. I think she's still here. I don't think she's crossed. Okay. No. Which way are you going to go? Okay.
Don't know.
Cool.
Winging.
All right. Enjoy.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, VM. Okay. Let's try and get a view of the Speke's Hinged tortoise's head. Oh, I was telling you a mongoose story. That's what I was in the process of doing, and then I got distracted by a bird, and then I got distracted by a tortoise, and all in all, the story didn't quite finish. Anyway, so if you remember correctly, our tortoise is, hold on, just poking his head out, we'll have to put that story on hold once again. Hello, little tortoise. I think Speke's might be my favourite tortoises, just because I've seen them so many times on quarantine clearings, which is a big open area outside our house, fighting each other. They're like little bulldozers, little tanks, whenever the males fight each other. And those claws on those feet, seriously sort of adapted for the way in which they walk, especially when one finds oneself in such a tricky spot. They don't seem to think about going round obstacles. There's none of that really happens. It's more just let's bulldoze through it and see if I can disappear even further. Amazing they don't poke their eyes. Now, is it pushing up against that leaf or is the leaf in its mouth? I think it's pushing up against the leaf. Okay, little tortoise. We'll leave you be. We'll pretend that... Is it in its mouth? Can't be. It's a dead leaf. It wouldn't eat a dead leaf. Okay. Let us leave our tortoise and go check along Mumba Road. Even though Brent's checked it, you never know. She might pop out. Might just be good timing. Right, the mongoose story. The long-awaited mongoose story. If you cast your mind back to the start of the story, we'd got back and there was a massive puff adder sitting in one of the holes. Of course, there was concern that perhaps it had managed to catch and eat the little ones. It did have an oddly shaped bulge in it. And the adults arrived back and were clearly in a state of absolute panic. They were squeaking and calling and contact calling, really very frantic, and rushing backwards and forwards, mobbing the snake and then trying to get into their hole to check that the babies were not there. And it transpired, eventually the mongoose couldn't find anything, so they started ranging further and further, and we followed them. and it transpired that the sub-adults, despite not being fully grown themselves, and at great what would for them have felt like great personal risk, they had carried the babies to another safe spot, running backwards and forwards. And it's amazing the altruism that certain mammal groups will show to each other. Eventually, they were reunited with much squeaking and happy grooming and reaffirming those bonds between the members of the group. And I imagine that a dwarf mongoose situation would be exactly the same. I somehow have a feeling it's very similar social structure. Oh, I'm sorry, Emily. We lost our signal, and I never finished your question about where you can get a bird list. The internet should have one. I know that you can buy hard copies in the Kruger National Park, in the park shops. And I think, Emily, I think there might even be, on the AfriCams website, there might even be a list of birds that you can hear, complete with their calls, if you would like to have a look at that. AfriCam, of course, was the original concept behind Wild Earth. Well, sort of. It was the beginnings of Wild Earth. So have a look on the AfriCam website. I think there's a list of birds that you can see here. That might be one place to start looking, but I'm sure the internet will have a bird list of the Sabi Sand. Trying to think, and I know that Kruger does sell them, and you can go there and you can check off the lists. There's the Inyala that Brent were with earlier, having emerged out of the thicket. One massive male and a couple of slightly smaller females. That pretty much tells me that Kruger probably isn't around here, or at least they haven't spotted her. He beautifuls. It's been such a lovely morning so far, and it's really topped off. It's put me in such a good mood that the Nkuhumas are looking so healthy. It really has. What's happening there with the ladies? I think they're having a little bit of a scuffle on the left of the big Nyala bull. Some rushing around. Let's see if they will let us get a little bit closer and maybe we can see what they're up to. Sometimes in cold weather, Nyala play in the most entertaining way. They chase each other round, they headbutt. They, all in all, they just have a blast, particularly the young ones. They gamble. And it's such, I don't know, personally I find one of my favorite things to see. I love seeing all animals and all, mister, blocked us now. I love seeing all of the animals, but one of my favorite things to do or to see is to see animals playing. There's something about that lightheartedness that I think we find really easy to relate to, whether it's the lionesses playing with each other or the antelope or elephants. I really enjoy watching them play. Wildebeest as well, also thoroughly entertaining. But they've stopped now just because I said something. Think of just these two little youngsters that were causing trouble. And sometimes female and Nyala fight, you know. Not seriously, not nearly as seriously as the male, but every now and again they do have a little head-butting session. And I'm never fully sure if it's in earnest or if it's in playfulness. We had one sighting where we had Nyala doing obstacle courses, round and round and round and round, and then when they got dizzy, they'd change direction and go round and round and round, jumping up and jumping over. It's fun to watch. But I think these guys are a little bit more interested in breakfast. There is one last road that I need to check in the search for the Queen of Juma. So while we go and look at Batalia Road, let's go and see, on the subject of Batalias, what Byron has found.
We're just watching a vulture soaring above us, quite far away. It's drifting off now. And that's interesting because it's not very warm, so there probably aren't any thermals around. Although it is quite windy, so it's maybe caught some wind, able to fly around and search for food. But interesting to see it just flying in weather like this. It's not usual for us to see vultures flying around. But I did get to this beautiful big tree which has been stripped of its bark by elephant, unfortunately. and you can see the damage that they've caused. Now the elephant, what they do is, I'm trying to see here, I can see a mark right here. And what's happened is the elephants come and they push their tusk into the side of the tree, and then that loosens the bark, and then they'll use their trunk to strip the bark off, and they'll tear it down and they'll feed on it. Now the reason for that is these trees contain, or the bark rather, contains something known as the cambium layer, which is the inner layer of the bark, and that contains all the nutrients that are being transported from the roots to the tree and vice versa, so up and down the tree. So it's a vital part of the tree. And what happens is, if the elephants strip the bark right around the tree, it's known as ring barking, and that will usually cause the tree to die because it hasn't got the ability to transport its nutrients. You can see they're stripped all the way up, so as they pull, they just strip these long pieces of bark off of these trees. Now this is a knob thorn, another big knob thorn, acacia tree, so part of the acacia family. And the bark is quite easy to strip off, I think, for the elephants. But what I've noticed is something else very small. Have a look here. There's a pupa casing of sorts. Now, I'm not entirely sure, but it does look, and I'm almost certain, this is from a cicada bug. And the cicada, what happens is when the larva goes into pupa stage, as it hatches, the cicada bug will fly off and peel its way out of here, and I think that's exactly what that is. Fascinating, isn't it? I'm not sure, but it does look like it. So it's interesting to have a look at these trees and see what you find hiding in the bark. You'll get other insects like scorpions, spiders, all climbing into the side of the bark in the open spaces, looking for homes. I think, however, this tree, it may still survive. And even though this was fairly recent, but there's still half of the tree that has got bark on it, and that might be enough to keep this tree alive. Only time will tell. So as we were walking around through that drainage line earlier, we were having a look to see if we had any signs of Karula, whose tracks we saw earlier this morning. But unfortunately, there was no sign. And we did see some hyena tracks moving through the area, but no other sign of Karula. And that squirrel that we heard alarm calling earlier, was just a paranoid squirrel, I think. There was nothing there. We had a look around. It may even have seen a bird of prey soaring above us in the distance. I'm not sure, but we couldn't see anything. We're going to continue. I'm actually heading back towards the last place we had tracks of Karula, just to see if we can find out exactly which direction she went. While I do that, let's head back to Brent for an update.
Well, it pays to be a paranoid squirrel when everything's trying to eat you out here. And we're still having a quick look around Treehouse Waterhole. Now, I know a lot of you have asked, and I keep forgetting, so I've remembered, why is this called Treehouse Waterhole? And if we go into that marula tree there, you can see the remnants of a treehouse. You can see there a gum pole, and a little bit up to the right, you can see a few more there. Now, this is from way back when, probably 50s, 60s, and the Treehouse Waterhole is one of the only natural seeps in this area. So the water table is quite high, it's at the base of a seep line, and with elephants, you can see where they dig out the holes there to produce water. Even when there's no water around, they'll dig for the water. There we go, you can see they've been up and at it there. So this was actually some of the only water around in the 50s and 60s before the man made water holes like that. And what happened was, very different time in those days. This area was still, they were still attempting to farm cattle here. And a lot of these permanent water holes There would have been a hide there for shooting of predators, lions, leopards, hyenas. Of course, that stopped a long, long time ago, thankfully. But there's another place to the south on the Manuleti River called Martley Pools, which is another natural seep. And in the tree there, there's actually a place where they carved how many lions, how many leopards, how many hyenas were shot from that particular hide. Of course, it's very, very different now. There hasn't been hunting in the Sabi Sands for many, 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 many years. It was a different time, and people had different ideals then. So it's easy to persecute, but hindsight is an exact science, and they didn't know they were doing anything wrong. If you think about probably one of the most famous conservationists in South Africa, Lieutenant Colonel Stevenson Hamilton, who Skukuza is named after. Skukuza is his Shangaan nickname, which is after the widow birds. And when they first started the Kruger National Park, all lion, wild dog, hyena, leopard, cheetah, jackal, all predators were shot on site to protect the other animals. So you must think that how much conservation has changed, how much of a better understanding we have now than we did even 20 years ago. Okay, Queen Karula is being a sneaky, sneaky, sneaky leopard. None of us can find tracks anywhere apart from the last track we saw this morning. She has been known to zig and zag and jig and jag. One of the hardest leopards to track. A lot of leopards will purposely march in a straight line. Not our Karine, not our queen at all. She likes to keep us on our toes. Now, there's much debate in camp as to whether the weather is going to dump the predicted 120 mils on us between tonight and tomorrow. Clouds are still quite high, and I don't know. For me, the pressure doesn't feel low enough for us to get rain now. Of course, that might change during the day. Vim, do you think we're going to have the massive rains over the weekend?
That's why all the hippos running away.
Yes, Vim thinks definitely, because there are literally hippo tracks everywhere this morning. Literally the whole Mwati River from the beginning to the end is a hippo track. Hippo tracks on Cheetah Cut Line, hippo tracks on Vuyatela Access, hippo tracks on Weaver's Nest, hippo tracks on Philemon's Cut Line. Hippo tracks everywhere. A lot of hippos doing a lot of movement last night, including the naughty hippo who broke our deck. Okay, well, we can't find Karula, but we can find her track. I'm going to show you her track quickly. It's about a few seconds away. Actually, Byron's where we last saw her tracks earlier this morning. I saw him there. But it's probably going to be better for Byron to show you the tracks from Bushwalk. But in the meantime, let's jump back on board with Jamie, see what she's up to.
Well, speaking of the predictions of rain, I've just remembered what's going to happen after breakfast, and I believe that some of us have a date with several shovels and several sandbags. Brent went to town yesterday, he bought 20 sandbags in order to block up things like the tent and things like people's rooms to stop them from flooding in case we do have a sudden downpour that the area that the soil just can't soak up. That means we're going to be going into the Mwati with some shovels, and we're going to be filling sandbags after breakfast this morning. So I hope that Amanda has prepared us a hearty breakfast so that we might be energized for the task ahead. It's been a while since I've had to do sandbagging. Could be thoroughly entertaining. Right, Karula, we've only got a few more minutes to try. No, maybe that was a bit difficult. It was a pair of mating dragonflies, and I could barely see where they went. Sorry, Gert. I don't know that was going to work. That was very optimistic of me. Mating dragonflies, of course, they mate in the air. So the female, the male grasps the female, and he does most of the flying, and she sort of dangles underneath him with her abdomen curled upwards. It's wonderful to see, but it's something very difficult to get on camera. Last check of the Mulwati, we've done Batalia, we've done pretty much every single road on Juma. I think we've just missed her. We've just missed our appointment with the Queen this morning. And of course, it is entirely based on her schedule and not ours. She comes and goes as she pleases. Well, we haven't been... We have not been successful with the search for Queen Karula. We have run out of time. We'll have to try again on the sunset safari. I've had a wonderful time, so big thank you to Khat for his wonderful camera work, as well as to all of you for joining us. I hope you've had as much fun as I have, and I will see you on the sunset safari. But for now, let's go over to Byron so that he can show you the track of the Queen we've been searching for.
Saw the tracks of Karula, and I'd like to show them to you. And there's a beautiful track right here. Nice soft sand. Move that out the way. Just circle this track. Look at that beautiful leopard track in the soft sand. Isn't that fantastic? Now, when was it? Yesterday, I think, yesterday morning, I spoke about the hyena track, and it's got two lobes at the back pad. And I said the cats are different, and now you can see this clearly. So let me get down. Oh, there's another nice track. Let me just see. There's a really nice one over here, Jandre, if you can have a look. It's not as clear, but the back pad is very clear. You can see there's one, two, three lobes. And that's the whole track, or the back pad rather. And then the one, two, three, four toes. So that's a cat track, and then you can see again over here clearly one, two, three lobes, and those very clear four toes. Now her track actually looks a little bit bigger here, but the reason for that is because it's in the soft sand. So what's happened is, as she stands in the soft sand, her feet will spread like this, so it looks like the track's actually bigger than what it is. Because of the soft sand, it just spreads open a little bit more. So it's not a good indication of the size of a track. A track's probably a bit smaller normally, but because of the soft sand, it's spread open a lot more. But isn't that wonderful? Lovely to see fresh leopard tracks like this. From this morning, we know, unfortunately, we couldn't find her. She seemed to evaded us, but that's what leopards do. They're not one of the most elusive cats for nothing. They are very, very shy, and if they don't want to be seen, you're not going to see them. Anyway, we're going to be heading back to camp now. We've had a wonderful morning walk. I hope you've all enjoyed it with us. Thank you to Jandre on camera, and of course to Herbert for walking with us. We'll see you all this afternoon. We're going to head back to Brent now for the closing. Goodbye, everyone.
That queen of ours. Hopefully, we have a bit more luck with her on the sunset safari, and we'll be able to pull her out of the bush by the tail. Oh, what we got flying there, Viam? A big bird up in the sky. It's a white-backed vulture. Now, vultures are not fond of this weather. Cool weather, not many thermals for them to ride, makes it more difficult for them to find those lion kills. They got to do the work. Flappity flap, flap, flap. Vultures don't like flapping their wings. They'd much prefer to catch some warm air and then glide their way to a free meal. Look at those long primary feathers on the tips there. And you can see how, along with the tail, that they're used as rudders. It is absolutely incredible when you actually start looking a little bit closer. Oh, and over our head he goes. Well done, fam. That was nice. So, there we go, a vulture. We haven't found any too many new bird species. Now, I've also come round to quarantine to see if I can find any new flowers. But I think we're going to have to wait a day or two after the rain. Definitely should go check around Cheetah Cutline. Unfortunately, there's quite a few lions there, so it makes picking flowers a little bit dangerous. but we will definitely have a look possibly on the Sunset Safari. And again, a happy Thanksgiving to all of those in the United States of America. Hopefully your Thanksgiving dinner manners were a little bit better than the Nkuhuma Pride. And you see, it's there's tracks of a fictitious animal here. It's called a hyena. I haven't seen one in so long. I don't know what they look like anymore. I was also hoping we might find a baby impala in quarantine, but alas, not yet. They might be out for the Sunset Safari. They're definitely, hopefully, after last night, a few more little babies around. What can I hear? We've got 60 seconds to produce something. What can we produce? Where is it? I can hear him calling so nicely, and I cannot spot him. There he is, Vim. There's a little sunbird. Which one is it? A little Mariko sunbird. Yay. Chirpy, chirpy, chirpy this morning. But it has been wonderful having you all on the Sunrise Safari from Vim, aka the Wildebeest, and myself. We've had a splendid time. Unfortunately, no Karula, but wonderful interactions with the incredible Nkuhumas, and great, they're starting to look much better, they're starting to move again. We might not see them as often, but it's better for the pride, and hopefully they go from strength to strength as we get more rain. Okay, and that's us for today. It's been, as I said, marvelous. We'll see you in a few short hours for the Sunset Safari. Toodaloo for now.